One of the most famous American New Year's traditions is when a giant ball drops at midnight over New York City's Times Square. For something not as famous, but maybe more interesting, take the acorn drop in Raleigh, North Carolina, a fitting event for the City of the Oaks. There's also a pickle drop in Mount Olive, North Carolina, home of a brand that makes pickles, and in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, where peep candy is made, well, there's this. Now, this is the part of the show where we usually drop in a corny pun. And honestly, we'd be in a pickle if we didn't. A lot of peeps would drop us complaints if we didn't ring in the new year with new puns. And frankly, just saying them is a ball. They're an auld lang sign that things are back on track. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. ...1600 Pennsylvania Avenue and 10 Downing Street are two of the most famous addresses in the world. And not just because of the people who live there. One particular resident of the British address prowls below the political radar, but still catches far more fans than mice. For 10 out of 10 today, we're tracking down Larry the Cat.
It's been a year of political instability around Brexit.
We've had a meaningful vote. We had it in the referendum on 2016.
The debate rages on in Downing Street. In or out? No, not of the EU, but of number 10 itself. Larry the Cat just can't make up his mind. With no cat flap, Downing Street's chief mouser commands a squad of policemen with little more than a glare. And with videos like this one, which went viral, he has a huge international fan base. He's been in power since 2011, joining number 10 during David Cameron's administration. Speculation that the Prime Minister and Larry didn't see eye to eye were put straight in Cameron's resignation speech.
And the rumour that somehow I don't love Larry, I do. And I have photographic evidence to prove it. Sadly, I can't take Larry with me. He belongs to the House and the staff love him very much, as do I.
Under new Prime Minister Theresa May, divisions soon became evident. A leadership challenge from a feline in the Foreign Office, Palmerston. Debating long into the night, with neither willing to back down. A harbinger of the fight to come between their respective ministers, Theresa May and Boris Johnson, who alongside fellow party rebels recently failed to oust her. Larry is an opinionated pundit with over 200,000 followers on his unofficial Twitter page. But one wonders if some of it is fake news. He recently said he rejected an offer from the Prime Minister to be the next Brexit secretary.
We still think he'd make a good leader, especially with a more fitting name. Consider Theresa May, David Catmaron, or Gordon Havana Brown. Let's not forget about Tony Shorthair and John Mayshar True, and of course the famous Mouse Grit Catcher. All excellent meownikers for a prime meownister. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. There's been a new visitor making the rounds at a cat cafe, so of course this would rate 10 out of 10. Vector is the name of a toy robot that can do simple things for people like tell the weather or set a timer. But it can't see pets, so its engineers brought it here so that it could take pictures and be programmed to identify cats. Some of the animals seemed mildly amused, some didn't. We're not sure what Vector would do if a cat attacked, but Vector probably wouldn't be Victor. Not sure how many bites it would take, but with too much hard wear, the robot could short circuit. It could get its whiskers crossed. If it tips over, the results could be dreadful. And with cats on the prowl, they'd have to closely monitor Vector. It's a good thing it doesn't come with a mouse. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. Freshly baked bread and vending machine. Two things that don't sound like they go together. But they could with the BreadBot. It's a vending machine that can do all the steps to turn dry ingredients into fresh bread in about an hour and a half. Its makers estimate that each BreadBot would retail at around $100,000. It'd be leased to grocery stores, and the company says the machine would increase their profits and help the environment. Could lead to confusion when you brought it home, though. Hey, is that store-bought? Yeah, it's BreadBot. I know it's bread, but is it from the store? Yeah, it's store-bought BreadBot. But how is it BreadBot if it's store-bought? At the store, I bought BreadBot. What do you mean that it's bread bought? Look, just try it. It saved me some bread. I mean, it saved me some dough. I mean, I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Not all of the concepts introduced at the Consumer Electronics Show, a massive trade show in Las Vegas, Nevada, live up to their hype. 3D TVs got a lot of attention years ago, and more recently, curved TVs and ones with flexible screens, but those don't always make it to American living rooms. Still, if you're straining your eyes to see what the screens of the future could look like, there are a few better places to start.
These prototypes from LG Display give us a sense of what televisions might be like in the future, or maybe even the near future. You see these vibrant colors? Don't get fixated on that. This is all about the potential of mobility, taking a screen from your home office, and because it's so light, just being able to take it to your kitchen, your bedroom, wherever. The power, the data, everything the screen needs to function, coming through one single USB-C cable. It's cool, but is it necessary? Only the future consumer can decide that. This screen is 88 inches. The speaker is also 88 inches. That's because the screen literally is the speaker. And what that technology allows this screen to do is move the sound 100% in sync with the image. So you may not be able to hear this at home, but as these UFOs go up and down, I can hear the sound moving up and down. What about a transparent television? This OLED technology means that each pixel is creating its own light, strong enough to make this commercial concept. But what if one day this were your bedroom window?
Of course, those who remember CRTs could find this new tech cathodic. There's always a ray of interest in the future of the tube, and if your New Year's resolution is to keep your antenna tuned for the very high definition of what's at the 4K front, you're sure to CES something new at a show where electronics is its middle name. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. All cars drive. Some prototypes can fly. What about a car that walks? That's a concept that a South Korean car maker showed off at the Consumer Electronics Show. But why? Well, let's say you needed to climb a 5-foot wall or step over a 5-foot gap, but you wanted to stay in your car. Or maybe more practically, what about getting across rough ground after an earthquake? That's why the concept was developed. Maybe it'll see production, maybe it won't. Only time will tell if the idea has legs. True, some drivers are well traversed in technology, and some may think cars need to be willing and amble right out of the gate to step out of the traipsings of traditional driving and march forward in pace with a promenade to walking. Others may be more driven to just drive. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. TVs have gotten a little bigger since Super Mario Kart was first released on the Super Nintendo in 1992, but a 65-inch LED has nothing on this 100-foot-tall Jumbotron. This video was recorded by a news helicopter that just happened to be flying by the home stadium of the Kansas City Royals while someone was playing Mario Kart. The Royals team charity said on Twitter that the game was being played as part of a fundraiser. So Yoshi, it was for a cause. If you're jealous, you can't Rosaline on anger. That gets towed after a while. You gotta be a good Koopa Troopa and get Mari over it. At least you got to day see it on a Bowser. And let me just conclude that gaming on a Jumbotron looks like a more ton of fun. We should all make peach with the fact that it's a great cart of Major Luigi Baseball. I'm Carl Azuz, CNN 10. Hope you have a great weekend. A boy from California accidentally left his stuffed animals at a hotel in Hawaii, and that's when their vacation turned awesome. The teddy bear and stuffed seal got to chillax by the pool. Yeah, I said chillax, 2009. Sunbathing, a spa treatment, a personal tour by the staff, all part of it. And it was that same staff who, after finding the lost toys, took them on this photo shoot, packed them up, and sent them home safe and sound to their owner. So how was their vacation? Plush. How'd it make them feel? Soft. How are they after the five-star cuisine? Stuffed. And they can't build a bear the weight until they get back to where they'd been. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. Usually, when people ask what you've got under the hood of your car, they mean horsepower. This is an entirely different animal. A man in Florida discovered the boa constrictor when he went to do some work on his SUV. And then we called a couple different organizations to remove it. They either couldn't or they wanted to charge more than he could afford. So a neighbor stepped in with a coat hanger and used it to tote away the stowaway. Car trouble can always be dangerous, but this was downright constricting. He had no idea how the intruder snake in. It left him with a Cadillac of options and he just didn't know how else to escalate it. Thankfully, he didn't own a Viper, a Cobra, a Cougar, Jaguar, or Barracuda. That would have been much more cars for concern. I'm Carl Azuz. Things you'd expect to see at a boat show. A place to park? Check. Boats? Check. More boats? Check. Coyote in the bathroom? Now that'll make a splash. At Music City Center in Nashville, Tennessee, a wild animal ran past a security checkpoint and onto the exhibit floor of the Nashville Boat Show. Employees somehow trapped it in a bathroom, and then a police officer used catch poles to get the coyote into a police car and later release it in the woods, where its friends greeted it with a yip, yip, hooray. It's terrible. We don't know what the coyote wanted with a coyote. Maybe it floated the idea of muzzling its way aboard in the hopes of hunting seafood. Maybe it just wanted to showboat. Whatever it was, it seemed pretty candid about the whole thing. They ought to name one of those vessels Coyote McBoatface. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. On Twitter, the city of Westbrook, Maine says it looks like the moon has landed. If you don't know what this is, we'll pause it for a second so you can take a guess. Okay, give up? It's an ice disk that formed in a river that passes through the city. It's 100 yards in diameter. It's natural, but scientists say it's pretty rare, and that this one likely rotates the way it does because the current of the passing water pushes it that way. So if you're where it's brisk and you stumble on a disk, do not take a risk and let it take you for a whisk. The ice is pretty thin. You won't want to take a spin. It may give you quite a grin, but you could fall right in. So take it all right in. Make our show begin again. It's to no one's chagrin, watched on CNN 10. When it comes to ice, keeping distance is quite wise. It's far better you just view it than maybe fall right through it. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's all we have to discuss on CNN. Lesser-known creations made with three-dimensional printers. Musical flutes, shoes, a bridge. And unlike the 3D-printed coat hooks or phone cases you've seen, this thing is made of concrete and it spans more than 86 feet over a pond in Shanghai, China. Dozens of hollow concrete sections were printed and then joined together to make it. The bridge is also said to be more than 30% cheaper to build than a traditional one. Of course, it's not a bridge over troubled water. It may not get many size. For those who can't travel to China, it's a bridge too far. And people who build bridges on rivers might ask, why? But it does take old methods and bridge them with new technology, so we'll see if it spans the test of time. I'm Carl Azuz. We'll be off next Monday for the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. We'll look forward to seeing you Tuesday when CNN 10 returns. Whether you love gazing at the sunrise or the sunset, this hotel could let you see 16 of them per day. It's the world's first space hotel, or is it space's first world hotel? Right now, it's neither. The low orbit sleeper is just a proposal at this point. But if it gets built, developers say you could be staying in it in the year 2021. That is, if you have $9.5 million to spend on a 12-day spacecation. Well, it's not exactly a breath of fresh air. It's where all the stars stay. There's plenty of space available. It's great for weight loss. And if everything airlocks up properly, there's nothing to atmosphere. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. Extremely cold weather hit parts of Canada and the northern U.S. recently. The upside? Ice at Niagara Falls. Spectacular scenes were captured recently on the border between Ontario and New York State, including innumerable chunks of ice floating over the falls. Parts of Niagara have frozen before. Whenever temperatures dip below zero Fahrenheit and stick around for a while, you can expect to see clods and clouds of ice. Hard not to fall for that for a spill. We hear the view from the island was the GOAT, a veritable horseshoe-in for photographic excellence. It's a fast-breaking update on current events, and we thank you for taking the time to watch. I'm Carl Azuz, CNN 10 hopes you'll rush back in tomorrow. (Laughs) would have thought that being on thin ice could be so mesmerizing? Yeah, that's a pun. This is a lake in Norway. And what you hear is the sound it makes when someone skates on thin black ice. The man who took this video says the ice is 2 to 3 inches thick. According to National Geographic, black ice can be that thin and still support a skater. But there's also still the risk that someone could fall in. So, like, don't do it. Some say it's like the ice is singing. Let's hope its voice doesn't crack. That would change the tenor of an alto-wise enticing evening when haunting baritones strike a chord with harmony skaters, bringing fanfare to choral who lend an ear. I'm Carla Zeiss for CNN. A man in Iowa recently won the lottery. Well, not the jackpot. He won $1 on a scratch-off ticket. But he went to the state lottery headquarters and asked for the big prize treatment. And after a laugh, they gave it to him, printing up a big old check with the prize listed and making him feel like $1 million, if not the winner of it. He then went and blew it all in one place. He bought a half gallon of gasoline. Well, many lottery winners move. He was able to move about 10 to 15 miles, depending on his car. It might not be a jackpot of gold, but it was probably worth the grand prize of admission, and you got to credit him with keeping it lotto real. If we had $1 for every time we covered a story like that, it might not be a lottery, but it'd be the same as that lottery winner. I'm Carl Azuz, CNN 10. Hope you have a great weekend. In Davos, Switzerland, there's a hotel you can only stay at once, or at least for one season, because when the weather warms up, it melts. It's called the Igloo Hotel. The rooms and the art on the walls are carved out of snow and ice. It costs between $300 and $1,000 for a one-night stay in a private room. And though it has some of the amenities of other hotels, like a restaurant, a pool, and a sauna, it doesn't have heat.
It's called an Igloo Hotel, a hidden lair high in the Swiss Alps, built each year from packed snow, a perfect place for a bear to spend a long, cold winter.
And I can tell you, what an epic journey it's been so far to get here. We've slid down a blue run, we got to the top of the mountain, we're being swished and swayed by skiers. Welcome to my ice palace. Hi.
Hello, how are you?
Freezing. So here we are at the entrance of the igloo. You're going to take me on a tour. I can see a signpost as well. We've got plenty of options.
Exactly. Here we can see, like, we have Hawaii, we have Japan, and we have Tasmania Island. And let's go there and check
Tasmania.
It out.
Can we Tasmania. Do Hawaii as well at some point? It's going to be a bit warmer.
This hotel has all the bear necessities. 15 igloos, so lots of room for lots of bears.
Oh my goodness. Now, this is an important piece of the jigsaw puzzle that I didn't consider. Oh, Elias, you brought me to my princess room.
Of course.
Hooray!
Here we have a bed made out of snow with some mattresses, sheepskin. We have an inner sleeping bag that people can use. We have light over there.
If you've never tried this, I'm not sure you would believe how comfortable and cozy this bed is. But all I can say is it's like, you know, lying on a cold cloud. Right, let's tuck myself in. Lights out. Thank you.
Adventurous guests might be alpining away for that kind of snowtell, but those who like to park a somewhere warm will want to catch a lift and pick up the skis to a heated room. They might lose their cool and become hot-headed after the cold reception in a place that'd be their last resort. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN.
Dubai.
A sheep recently wandered into a neighborhood in South Carolina, so a policeman came to corral the mammal before animal control got there. Seems they had a lot to talk about.
Come on, come on, come on. I'm taking you to greener pastures. I don't know what you want to eat, man. Well, look at this clover right here. Clover is a very calming thing. Have you ever had clover honey? Clover tea? This is not how I pictured my Tuesday going at all.
But thanks to the dashboard camera, it went pretty well for the rest of us. Guess the animal was just trying to cop a snack, and maybe the policeman was so patient because he has a bleating heart. Officers are used to pursuing suspects on the lam, but this one was woolly unusual. It required a sheerly careful approach that was right on the mutton. I'm Carl Azuz, keeping things sheep-shape on CNN 10. At Gatwick Airport in London, UK, a new type of parking attendant is making headlines for being completely robotic. It's named Stan. It looks a little like a miniature flatbed truck, but when a car is ready to be parked or picked up, Stan shows up, hoists it up like a forklift, and then ferries it to its space. The company that makes the robot says it can create up to 50% more spaces for cars, apparently by parking them closer together. It reportedly comes at a cost of several million dollars, though, so the question will be if airports can stand the fee and if travelers can stand the wait if Stan shows up valet. Could mean less parking and less tipping unless the robot starts slipping and then renters have to find a space to park themselves. Can you stand the puns on CNN? Ten out of ten today comes to us courtesy of some California sheriff's deputies who recently rescued a lost bull elephant seal. They teamed up with fish and wildlife officials to coax him, this probably counts as coaxing, to head back across the road and toward the sea. That's easier said than done for a massive mammal that can weigh up to 5,000 pounds, but he did make it back to his herd. We may never know why the elephant seal crossed the road. Maybe he was just snout for a walk. Maybe he made a rookery mistake. Maybe he thought it was a safe crossing for pedestrians. Either way, it seals up another show on a happy note, so there's nothing for him to blubber about. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. You might be able to beat your little brother at Jenga, but could you beat a robot? Engineers from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology have built one that uses a gripper, a sensor that detects force, and a camera. Its purpose? To dominate the tower game of 54 blocks. Okay, but so what? Well, the makers say their robot could eventually help out in assembling the things we buy, or separating recyclable objects from trash. So is this a towering achievement? Will it topple the human champion? Will it loosen a whole other level to the game that brings it to new heights? We wouldn't know right now, and we haven't Jenga got enough time left to extract an answer, but we can say it stacks up the block party. The puns have come crashing down on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. Golden Colorado, Golden Retrievers. Coincidence? No, not at this gathering in the Centennial State. It's called the Goldens and Golden Gala. It was held on National Golden Retriever Day. It brought together animals from all dog walks of life, and it might have set a record, too. There were reportedly about 1,000 golden retrievers and their owners here. A previous record in Scotland brought around 361 dogs. So for fans of goldens, the idea was pure gold. But if they can have goldens and golden, can someone host Airedales and Adairville, Bassets and Bassett, Bostons and Boston, Chihuahuas and Chihuahua, Collies and Colleyville, Labradors and Labrador, Maltese and Malta, Papillons and Papillon, Terriers and Terre Haute, or Yorkies and Yorkshire? That'll give them something to yap about. And it takes a bite out of another edition of CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. Today I learned that the average avocado weighs around 6 ounces. Not this beast. It's closer to 6 pounds. For years, a local farmer's been bringing fruit like this to a hospital in Hawaii, just to share. The Guinness World Record for largest avocado is 5 pounds, 8 ounces, so these may very well beat that. The farmer says gigantic alligator pears, as they're also called, have been growing on a tree his brother planted in 1941. As some people put it, holy guacamole! If you find that fruit appealing, it's enough to salad bowl you over. He should write a book on the avocados and avocadon'ts of growing them. It's enough to make other farmers green with envy. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. Superhero crime fighters have always had a way to shoot a rope or a web around people who are trying to get away. Now, that kind of technology is becoming available to real-life crime fighters. This thing is called the Bola Wrap. It's not considered a deadly weapon, but it uses a blank charge to fire an 8-foot rope toward a suspect. and its makers say it's effective as long as that suspect is between 10 and 25 feet away from the officer. Suspects would then get tied up, roped in, wrapped up, tethered tight, fastened down, knotted up, cinched in, bound together, hamstrung, or leashed up. They probably wouldn't get away. I'm Carl Azuz, totally tongue-tied for CNN. Family reunion gets a 10 out of 10 today, but it's a family that's a little odder than you're used to. Literally, a little odder. It was found earlier this week by a commercial fisherman after the pup became separated from its mother. Officials recorded the pup's cries and then played them over a speaker so the mother could hear. After they located her, they tossed the pup in, and after a few moments, she pops up to get her baby. Her baby's like no water, so you can't say she forgot her. Though a fisherman had caught her, Mama Otter had begot her, and it's clear that she had sought her so that when the man had brought her, it turned any Otter Day to a special Modder's Day. So if you catch one, don't play possum. Find the mom and then just toss him. It's a sample and example of how Fridays are awesome. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. The Kentucky Derby is said to be the oldest continuously held major sporting event in the U.S. The first race was run in 1875. For the second oldest sporting event, you have to trade in your horse for a dog. CNN recently visited the Westminster Kennel Club dog show, which started over the weekend in New York City.
Every February, the dogs descend upon Manhattan, and it's for the 142nd annual Westminster Kennel Club Dog Show. We have over 3,200 dogs coming this year.
Hey, this is the Meet the Breeds.
His name is Teddy.
This is Papa Chew Davos.
It's just a fun time, you know, just to get out and teach people about the breed.
And he really like learning about different breeds of dogs.
We have a boxer kissing booth, because why not?
There you go.
We have the 5th annual Masters Agility Championship going on.
This is my first time ever been
there. Yes, girlie, go, 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 go.
I've been watching them on TV, and it's just so exciting to see them in person.
This show is the second longest continuously held sporting event in the United States. And the reason it's been able to maintain that is the fact that it's about dogs.
I mean, man's best friend. What can't you not like about him?
So who will win best in show? Will a Doberman pinch the lead? Will judges be brought to their Pyrenees? Are spotted dogs worth a Dalmatian, or does it take a toy to chihuahua walk away with victory? You can greyhound us about this all you want, but if you're wondering why or aren't we telling you, it's because results haven't been pointed out yet. Those will be settled on Tuesday. Just didn't want you to think we were being malamute on the subject. I'm Corgil Azuz, and we'll spring her back with more for you tomorrow.
Reporting.
For 10 out of 10 this Tuesday, we're serving up some frozen fruit. Well, more frozen than fruit. These are called ghost apples. They're a product of both extreme cold and freezing rain in western Michigan. The man who captured them on camera says they formed when ice-coated rotten apples and the fruit itself slipped through, as apples have a lower freezing point than water. That left just some icy apple shells hanging on the trees. Of course, ghost apples are only a shell of themselves, but they are aptly named. It must stem or branch from the fruitographer's biting wit, a slice of his intelligence that we're happy to pick, peel, and share on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz, and how do you like damn apples? Of course, artificial intelligence systems still have a lot to learn, as seen in a recent debate between a human debate champion and an IBM computer named Project Debater.
Greetings, Harish. I have heard you hold the world record in debate competition wins against humans, but I suspect you've never debated a machine.
The machine had been uploaded with newspaper and magazine articles related to the debate topic, and it was supposed to take into account its human opponent's statements in forming its arguments. While Project Debater, the computer, was defeated, it still showed that AI systems are progressing toward increasingly complex tasks. You could say its style was robotic, but still it was a little bit hypnotic. It made sound bites news bites, and though it still would lose, it might take something monotone like robot voicemails on a phone and turn them into arguments that makes you wonder, are you meant to debate a debate machine, the kind that fakes a human being, the kind that seems relatable and makes debates debatable? It's all up for debate, I guess. I'm Carl Azuz on the Loose with CNN. Black Panther rates a 10 out of 10. In this case, we don't mean the movie, we mean the animals that was recently caught on camera in the African country of Kenya. It's also known as a black leopard, and there hasn't been a confirmed sighting of these cats on the African continent since 1909. Most of them live in Southeast Asia. A zoologist says now they've been caught on camera, there'd be a lot of value in protecting them in Kenya. Assuming the animals leapt, pardon the efforts. Then they might think posing for more pictures is panthering, but they are some cool cats, so you can't blame the researchers who spotted them from roaring with excitement. For CNN 10, I'm Carl Azuz. A lifelong baseball card collector recently visited a shop in Nevada and saw this. It's a 1921 Babe Ruth card. It was listed for $8, but because the shop owner thought it was a fake, he sold it for $2. Turns out it wasn't a fake. It's apparently one of the rarest baseball cards on the planet. And the collector says he's gotten 3 multi-million dollar offers for it. He says he doesn't want to sell it, but that he will give more money to the shop owner. Now, some may say to the collector, Sultan of S, what are you waiting for? Don't you, Bambi, know that card is a colossus of clout and could give a big bam to your bank account? But we can't rush to judge. That would be a behemoth of a bust and a pretty Ruth thing to do anyway. Yeah, Babe Ruth puns. You know they're a hit. CNN 10 will be back next Tuesday. We're off Monday for the President's Day holiday. We'll see you right here on the 19th. If you're planning a vacation for spring break and thinking of somewhere exotic, you might ask yourself why someone would spend $300 to sleep in a treehouse. I guess the answer lies in where the treehouse is, what kind of view it has, and how you get to it. Our 10 out of 10 feature takes us to Laos, a Southeast Asian country that's 68% forest.
Tomorrow.
Bye-bye.
But while you're given the chance to see the apes, actually given to see them isn't a given. And if you tried and failed, you might feel like giving up. But sooner or later, they might be given in before you're given out, and then you can all give in a selfie before you have to be given back home. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. If you think modern cars feature way too much plastic, here's a classic that has them all beat. It's a Volkswagen camper van made from Legos. Its builders used computer software to calculate how many plastic bricks they'd need. Then they assembled 400,000 of them and included a pitched roof, a 1960s style kitchen, and a sliding side door. At 1,500 pounds, it weighs less than a real van. With a 6-week build time, it took a lot longer to assemble. And while it has a number of vanatics, it's not for everyone. Some folks don't brick for Legos. Some already have too much on their plate. Some don't want to have to tile you that at any minute their car could fall to pieces. It gives them a pretty bad attitude. Others can let go of all that because these are the building blocks that make them plastic. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. Winning 10 out of 10 today, what could be the world's most extreme model plane. A Chinese farmer always dreamed of owning a passenger jet, but they're expensive, so he built his own. This is a model of an Airbus A320. It is life-sized. It reportedly took more than 60 tons of steel to build, and its materials cost the farmer almost $400,000. Along with a team of a few other farmers turned mechanics, they put this together in a little over 2 years. It's a dream of a model and a model of a dream. Maybe it'll never catch an in-flight airstream, but it's taken off an interest if not taken off the ground. It's a soaring success, even though it's earthbound. It's a one-to-one scale reproduction fantasy. Was it worth it? Well, that's plain to see. I'm Carl Azuz. CNN 10 is back tomorrow. In Japan, there's a restaurant that challenges you to eat more noodles than you thought possible. The small bowls of soba noodles are refilled as soon as you eat what's inside. And this lady managed to take down 300 bowls of them. That's the equivalent of 20 regular-sized bowls of noodles, so any way you do the math, it's a lot, y'all. The restaurant says its record was set when someone ate 570 small bowls, or about 38 regular bowls of soba, in one sitting. Finding someone to break that record would be like finding a noodle in a haystack. Critics might call that glutinous. Supporters might say it's worth waiting for, but if you're up for a challenging bowl game and you're bringing a souped-up appetite, it's tough to beat a lunch that's all you can eat. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. Skijoring, or skiering, is a sport you might not be familiar with. It combines the danger of skiing with the danger of horse racing for an unforgettable wintertime event. At a resort in southeastern Switzerland, you have to be at least 18 years old to participate in skijoring. You have to pass both fitness and intellectual tests, and you have to wear body armor. A two-time skijoring winner says you also have to give it a shot.
Skiing is a really special sport. We only do it here in St. Moritz. We need a thoroughbred in front and a skier behind. I done the skiing the first time when I was 18 years old. And I did it because it's amazing speed behind it, and I love the adrenaline. If you like to do skiing, you have to be, first of all, a really good skier, because you have to have a good reaction during the race. And the second thing you need is to have a good contact to your horse, to understand how a horse is working. And to be a good horseman is really important. And the third thing you have to be is you have to be really brave, because there is a lot of kickback coming from your own horse and a lot of speed. This is really important. During the race, you need a really good voice, because only with shouting we can make our horse faster. So for example, it's like, go Becky! You definitely have to try it, because it's full of adrenaline, full of speed, and it's in the nature together with a wonderful thoroughbred in front of you, and it's just amazing.
Boring? No. Skijoring is for those who feel like soaring, setting skis to snow and racing with a horse that does the pacing. It's not horsing round, it's horsing down a snowy track. They risk it because it's just like Elsa's magic harness right up to Seabiscuit. You can diss it, you can't miss it. It's an equine kind of show that brings tack and saddle, bit and bridle, thundering over snow. It combines the thrill of racing with the wintry sledding fun of a horse-powered machine that's thoroughbred to run. I'm Carl Azuz, photo finishing the week on CNN 10. A dive roller coaster is one that drops at 90 degrees, meaning you're diving straight down as opposed to a less steep downhill angle. And this is going to be the tallest, fastest, and longest dive coaster in the world when it's finished. It's called the Yukon Striker. It's set to open this spring at Canada's Wonderland theme park. Its main plunge is 245 feet straight down, and its top speed is 80 miles per hour. So what will be the fallout? Some will surely fall for it, and if you're thrilling to strike her out for a wild ride, Yukon too. But some will see it and want to roll her on by. If the thought of 90 degrees makes them sweat with their mind or stomach getting twisted up or off track or thrown for a loop, they won't want to ride out this dive of a coaster. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Every fall, a number of publications give advice on how to winterproof your home. But who could have expected this? Now you see it, nice little house. Now you see it covered in ice. It's located in upstate New York near the shore of Lake Ontario. The heavy winds of a storm blew ice all over the house, encasing it. The woman who lives there says it's 4 feet deep in some places. Thankfully, she can still get in and out through a back door. But when it comes to cold, if you don't love it, you're gonna list it and house hunt for something farther south. A fixer-upper is better than a freezer-upper, and no matter how good its bones are, a flip is a flop. If this old house is a vanilla ice project you didn't design on a dime, you'll want to be trading spaces in no time. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. Having the right tires can make a car fly. And in this case, we mean that literally. This is a tire company's concept. It's not real yet. It would have tires pull double duty as propellers that could reposition upward to take a car up, up, and away. It's being pitched as part of an autonomous car of the future. No idea how much something like this, plus the flying car, would cost. But if you're asking, why do you need four of them? It's because half that many would be too tired to fly. I thought that was a really good pun. You could almost hear the rim shot afterward. It's fun to take ideas like that for a spin. Not every pun has been spoken for, and we're always driven to ride out some more, even if that means sounding a little lug nutty at the end of the road. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. There are a lot of things that robots are learning to do these days. Take, for instance, watering a plant. Watering a cup, giving a fist bump, and making it blow up. One of the more impressive feats of this machine that was recently revealed by a Chinese technology company is its ability to thread a needle. It's part of an effort to show that robots are getting more dexterous and more effective at interacting with people. What comes next? We're hanging by a thread. If robots become tailors, what will tailors do instead? In the garment world, things ain't always as they seem. You just can't replace an expert's eye with that of a machine. It's not keen, it's too green. It can't drape the perfect jean. Artificial sensing, fashion sense when sensing had a preen. So if you're into tailoring and placing perfect stitches, don't be needled or be threatened by something that's got glitches. Azuz on the loose, sewing things up for CNN 10. For today's 10 out of 10 segment, we're taking you to Snow Maze. But Carl, don't you mean snow mass? No, I mean this. What Guinness World Records says is the largest snow maze on Earth. It sits on a cornfield in Manitoba, Canada. Its walls are 6.5 feet tall and 2 feet thick, and they're made of artificial snow, which is apparently stronger than the real thing. It took a farmer and his staff 6 weeks and more than $42,000 to put it together. A corn maze is a maze, but a snow maze is hazier. You can't be any lazier or make the maze less mazier. It takes amazing skill for the design and the solution, building passageways and ways to pass perfunctory occlusions. Some will think you're lost because to them it makes no sense for you to drop a huge expense upon some snowbound labyrinths. But if you have the maze and means, then by all means let them in so they can be about finding ways out if they don't hit dead ends. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Package delivery by drone. It could happen sooner than you think, but probably not in the way you think. This is what's currently being tested by a few American companies. Some of them even use self-driving technology. They can carry heavier packages than flying drones, and they won't get in trouble with the Federal Aviation Administration. Will they drop off your order sooner and save delivery companies the expense of that costly last mile? We don't know yet if they'll be able to deliver. They may be packed with features, but to become part and parcel of delivery, they'll need the backing of major companies before they're bundled with a bundle and cartoned off to make a drop-off without dropping off the tracking device that orders them around. A single accident could lead to a bad unboxing, and that's a can of worms no company wants to open. I'm Carl Azuz, shipping out another edition of CNN. The car company that brought the world the Beetle, also known as the Bug, may soon bring it the Buggy, the ID Buggy, with ID reportedly standing for Iconic Design. It's just a concept at this point, but it created a buzz, get it, at the Geneva International Motor Show last week. And Volkswagen says it might actually produce the electric dune buggy in small numbers as a way of attracting attention to VW's electric cars. It only seats two, it only has two doors. And while it made some fans bug-eyed, others will want to bug out when they begin to adjust their compound eyes to that bug-garish shade of green. Does it bug you? Or have you been bitten by the bug of curiosity and want to larva your beetle behind and metamorpha downsize to a wingless taxi? I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. When you see this winterized car for the first time, don't be fooled. It's no Mustang. It's Snow Mustang. A Nebraska state trooper found this and shared it on social media, saying that while some people make snowmen, in this part of the country, they make snow cars. The officer even gave it a ticket. A fake one, of course, for being double parked. Apparently, a local businessman and his kids formed this Frosty Ford. Forget 5.0, it's a 5-point snow. It's a cold weather curbside car you can't tow. Only where it's chillin' could you shape one if you're willing, but there's no way to be telling when your sculpture will be melted. So, if you're gonna make one, it has to be a fake one. You'd be sure to break one if you ever tried to take one. It's a truly cool vehicle that no one's gonna seize, and maintenance is easy because it needs no antifreeze. I'm Carl Azuz, on the loose for... We're not coming back down to Earth just yet. Since it's Throwback Thursday, we're looking back on NASA's Apollo 14 mission to the moon. While astronauts Alan Shepard and Edgar Mitchell were there in 1971, they explored the moon's surface, set up experiments, and climbed to the edge of a crater. But there's something Alan Shepard did afterward that golfers loved, though the ball he hit with his 6-iron did not actually travel for more than a mile. Glad we were able to wedge that in. It's definitely not par for the course of a moon mission, but it surely irons out the question of whether you can hit the links by moonlight. It's a slice of levity where there's less gravity, and even if there's no birdie to be seen, it's not like you're gonna get a mulligan. I'm Carl Azuz, teeing off with CNN 10 Future. There's no question that the new mayor of Fairhaven, Vermont is gonna be the GOAT. I don't mean greatest of all time, I mean the GOAT. This goat, his name is Lincoln. He won the vote after the town held a fundraiser. For $5, residents could put their pets on the list of mayoral candidates, and Lincoln trotted home with the victory. He's already taken the oath of office, and he's scheduled to be in the upcoming Apple Festival and Memorial Day Parade. We don't know about the donkey or the elephant. It's likely they'll both be just a little jealous and demand a ban on goats or want to see the count. Check the number of votes and get a recount. Uproar has the parties all fuming at the runaway mayoral favorite. A ruminant, will he be cud or will he be bad? Will he be the goatest they ever had? Will he swim in success and win the next vote? Guess it comes down to what floats your goat. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. The saying, bat in the belfry, usually applies to someone who's said to be a little crazy. What about having a bat in the newsroom? Is it gonna drive reporters batty? It did for a while at WCBI's newsroom in Columbus, Mississippi, when a flying mammal somehow found its way inside. A couple of fearless employees eventually trapped the animal in a conference room, and they didn't need to hold a conference to decide the bat was better off outside. The staff of WCBI then waved WC bye-bye, not batting an eye when Batman flitted back out into the dark night. Letting him hang out inside would have been a terrible idea. Even if you gotta wing it sometimes in news, some of the most battle-tested reporters would want to fly to a different echo location. I'm Carl Azuz, batting 1,000 for CNN 10. It's one thing to love video games. It's another to set a Guinness World Record for having the planet's biggest collection of them. Antonio Romero Montero has been collecting games for years. He owns games from his childhood, from overseas, some rare games, some he hasn't played, some he hasn't opened. He has so many games that it took two Guinness employees a week to count them all. The tally, 20,139. The cost, hundreds of thousands of dollars. Maybe you think he's a legend like Zelda to have all that Metal Gear simming around his house. If his Final Fantasy or Call of Duty was to have a world of software craft creating a mass effect, his golden eye for collecting his one Guinness Mari over, even if it's gotta have taken him longer than a fortnight to build such a super galaxy of titles. It's no Bioshock, that dude's got game, y'all. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Hella skiing. Using helicopters to reach remote places to ski has been around for decades. As far as we know, zeppelin skiing, using an airship to get out in the backcountry, is pretty new. These three Austrian skiers worked on the idea for almost 2 years before it became reality in February. They needed cold temperatures, clear skies, and no wind. They also needed to descend by rope to the alpine summit they intended to ski. Was it worth it? You'd better dirigible believe it. Of course, there were a few blimps in the road. Their path to success wasn't always zeppelinear, and it took a while before everything was in airship shape. Big dreams often have steep slopes and obstacles to traverse, but once theirs got off the ground, despite the ropes that repelled them, they all clearly had a descent time. I'm Carl Azuz, and we'll ski you later on CNN. We're wrapping up today's show with the rise of esports, or better said, another example of how esports are rising. Video gaming has gotten more competitive, more organized, sometimes more lucrative. Top gamers can earn millions of dollars per year, and they've got a fan base all their own. Some U.S. high schools are now proving the traction of esports by offering students the chance to letter in them. Their field is a screen.
Got him.
Let's go.
Nice.
At one point in time, this would just be a set of students playing video games. But here in Georgia, it's now an official high school varsity sport. As it is in only 7 other states nationwide.
It's a hobby that they're passionate about, and we want to encourage that and give them a pathway to a career in the future.
Kids could be walking around with letter jackets for gaming. That's nuts to me, and I love it.
Dr. Lupo, as he's known, plays video games for a living and streams his gameplay live for an audience of more than 7 million followers online. It's part of why State Farm signed him to an endorsement deal. A gamer.
I was like, wait, like State Farm? Like, really?
When we have Aaron Rodgers covering football and we work with Chris Paul in the NBA space, we've been starting to get much more involved in esports.
And they're not the only ones. If you watch the Super Bowl, then you probably remember this ad from the NFL.
Tonight is not about the league.
What's up, Juju?
Only that waiter wasn't a football player. He's a video gamer who goes by Ninja.
Those fans are as fanatic about their teams and the teams that they love in their esports world as I might be of the Chicago Cubs or the Chicago Bears.
It's a reality that makes a video game varsity season not too far-fetched.
It is such an honor because it's something that I've been trying to push and get into for a long time.
And fans say it's likely going to get even more competitive.
I got very lucky. It took a lot of work to get to where I am now. And even then, it's still not a guarantee.
No guarantee, but maybe more than ever, there are dreams.
Hey, pro teams, yo, Cloud9.
Old school gamers were Oregon Trail winners. They'd be fording all their rivers and hunting all their dinners. While some might take delight in Fortnite, others say their Call of Duty is a Counter-Strike. Is a day coming when game fans are gumming up? All the gyms, auditoriums, and running up, treating gamers like heroes of the storm, gearing up for battles like Gears of War. We'll have to overwatch to see what life brings. One thing for sure, it's all fun and games. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's a wrap for CNN. A man in Australia was recently out running errands. He left his car running to keep the air conditioning on for his dog, but he also left the door open, and look who else climbed aboard.
Can I get you to come out of my car, please?
At first, the answer was no. The two animals shared the air and the space separated by a seat. But eventually, the marsupial hopped out of the vehicle and took his rightful place in a nearby tree. Might have been a challenge to get the animal to cooperate, but it didn't seem to take a whole lot of time. The video helped corroborate the story. After a patient marsupial, the animal migrated to its arboreal home. It makes for a colorful conclusion to CNN10. Fridays are awesome. I'm Carl Azuz. You have a quality weekend. Chances are this guy's abs are stronger than yours. In fact, I don't know anyone who can hold a plank for 38 minutes. That's how long Andy Steinfeld reportedly stayed in the exercise. And the community center where he did it says it's a world record for his age group. The extreme senior athlete from Minnesota is 71 years old. He just finished radiation treatment for a type of cancer. And he says he did this to motivate other people. seems that much time would make you bored of a plank. It's hard to imagine the support you'd need to stay propped in such a hardcore exercise that seems to last abdomen all day long. Some would rather walk the plank than plank down the time to break the plank record, but if you've got the strength, it all comes down to isometrics. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. It's not always a good thing when someone calls you honey bear. It could mean there's been a theft. The evidence? Beehives at Pennsylvania's Susquehanna University were recently found toppled and slobbered on. There were no witnesses, but there is a suspect. And here is the awesome wanted sketch. While the Pennsylvania Game Commission is trying to trap the perpetrator with donuts, electric fencing's been put up around the remaining beehives. So the thief may strike again, but can he bear the shock? It would beehive him to take flight and honeycomb a different place for food. Of course, he could always brood around the yard in search of another colony, but before the insects were to drone on about one, they'd say it's none of his beeswax. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's The Buzz on CNN. For 10 out of 10, it's Alien, the play. Drama students at a New Jersey high school recently took a horror classic from 1979, adapted a script, and put it on stage. It was a budget production. One senior said the crew used whatever cardboard and scrap metal was lying around to build the set. But it was pretty convincing. The production went viral after viewers posted clips on social media, and the local mayor's office has funded an encore. Now you might be asking, what happened to our town? What kind of Midsummer Night's Dream led those students to Shrek tradition, not go into the woods, leave Alice in Wonderland, and take on a crucible that makes Beauty and the Beast look like the Little Mermaid? Maybe this December they'll sing a Christmas carol, but for now their little shop of horrors has them Mary Poppin' on social media. I'm Carl Azuz. After her last competitive dog show event, Gail, an American Staffordshire Terrier, was supposed to be flying home to enjoy her retirement in Amsterdam, Netherlands. But she broke out of her crate as workers were loading it onto the plane, and the 22-month-old dog went missing at the world's busiest airport in Atlanta, Georgia. 4 days later, as her handler was calling for her on airport property, Gail appeared and jumped into his arms. You'd think her owner would have been mad as a pit bull, but he didn't want to bite the hand that helped him. He said it was heartwarming, not heartwarming, that so many people would assist in bringing her bark. Of course, he might have a bone to pick with the airline, but we'll bury that for now and just say that when it comes to digging up news stories, dog rescues are always best in show. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. For 10 out of 10 today, the comfort of a hotel in a different shape. That's the idea behind Domes Charlevoix, a place where you can stay in Quebec, Canada, that gives you a unique view of the snowy landscape. Okay, but why not just camp outdoors? Well, the snow here can top 10 feet, and the temperature can drop to negative 22 degrees Fahrenheit. So this hotel could surround you in nature while also surrounding you with warmth. Of course, you're more likely to find chalet than valet parking. And for those prone to cabin fever, a dome could make their head spin, so they may want to Charlevoix it. But for travelers who like to stay ahead of the curve and hang around at their domestination, this could fill a Charlevoix, making for a dome-right awesome stay that makes them want to circle back. I'm Carl Azuz, and CNN 10 hopes you'll circle back here next Monday. Tis the season for some sneezing, and if you find pollen a pollen, you're gonna hate this. This video was shot from a helicopter passing over the woods. The clouds you see are the pollen, the masses of yellow fertilizing grains that the helicopter is blasting off the pine trees. Those of you with allergies are thinking, fly higher. This was shot recently in Georgia where allergy levels are high, and that's not helped by this low-flying chopper. If your eyes are watering, that 10 out of 10's a bust. Allergic sinuses and noses all flare up in a cloud of dust. It's unjust. In a gust, a tissue for us is a must. Springtime everywhere gets in your hair and coats your throat in crust. But you can trust that when the rain comes, your head becomes aware. It grounds the pollen down. It's bound to finally clear the air. I'm Carl Azuz, taking a deep breath on CNN. In Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the Liberty Bell has been bought by Taco Bell. They're selling gorditas under the clapper. Across Australia, McDonald's has added a new kind of burger called the McPickle. This is not real news. These are April Fool's jokes, an April 1st tradition that apparently dates back hundreds of years. So now that you've made it through another annual foolin', take a look at some of the history of the foolish tradition.
In ancient cultures, New Year's Day was celebrated on April 1st, but in 1582, Pope Gregory XIII moved the holiday to January 1st. Not everybody got the message. Those that continued to celebrate on April 1st were called April Fools. Funny, right? Much of Britain didn't adopt the new calendar until 1752, but they were celebrating April Fool's Day long before that. In Scotland, it's a two-day affair. If you've ever had a kick me sign taped to your back, you might blame the Scots. April Fool's Day has also been linked to the vernal equinox and the start of spring. That's when the ancient Romans had their hilarious festival of Hilaria, Hindus have Holi, and Purim is celebrated in Judaism. Some of the biggest April Fool's Day pranks are courtesy of corporations and the media. In 1940, a press release from the Franklin Institute, a science museum in Philadelphia, declared the world would end the following day. They were seeking publicity for a lecture series, and a local radio station reported on it. In 1957, the BBC falsely reported a bumper crop of spaghetti trees in Switzerland.
Another reason why this may be a bumper year lies in the virtual disappearance of the spaghetti weevil.
And in 1998, Burger King announced the left-handed Whopper, specifically designed for the 32 million left-handed Americans, including myself.
Where's the beef in that? After all, it's a hamburger. It's a left-handed compliment that someone might want it. They should do a taste test and see sand which is better. Sure, one is all right, but another option could give some people a left. Even if they had to charge a high five or more, they deserve a hand for not letting anyone, not even an April Fool, feel left out. I'm Carl Azuz, on the loose for CNN. If you're the adventurous type who wants to live somewhere exotic, you don't mind wearing a heavy suit whenever you step outside, and you just love the color red, this could be your future home. These are NASA's top three finalists for the 3D Printed Habitat Challenge. It's a $3.15 million competition for people to design a living space that could be built and potentially lived in on another planet, like Mars. These are just renderings. The next phase of the competition challenges teams to 3D print models of their designs. If you don't shun the idea of living abroad, we hear Mercury's warm this time of year, and Jupiter's said to be a gas. If you turn your sights elsewhere, you might Neptune your attention to something even farther. Distant destinations offer plutons of space if you're willing to plan it. That's all for CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. At first, it may look like a flock of birds, a really bright, colorful, artificially lighted flock. But surprise, it's drones! The technology company Intel put on the show to kick off a summit. You're looking at 500 shooting star drones. They're lightweight and have LEDs you can see. Intel says all they can really do is light up the sky, but that they do that really well. The display took place recently over Phoenix, Arizona. As long as they all work, it's a bright idea, a reflection of illuminating technology that plays like a semiconducted light orchestra. But no one would give them props if they were to get their wires crossed and go boom. Raining drones make for a bad forecast, a worse spin class, and a generally cathodious experience. We're glad no one crashed the party. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. Time to suit up and dive into our 10 out of 10 segment. You are looking at what will be the deepest pool in the world. It's currently being built in a town about 30 miles from the capital of Poland. It'll be 45 meters or 148 feet deep. It'll hold three times the amount of water of an average 25-meter pool. It's got 1,100 tons of steel to contain it, and it'll have a tunnel and hotel rooms for people who want to stay dry while they watch others swim. You gotta really plumb the depths to build a dive like that. Oh sure, some won't jump in thinking they're too cool for school, but others would be fish out of water if they didn't strain their funds, drain their piggy bank, and sink their money chlorine to a trip that lets them get in the swim and speedo down to the bottom of a well that makes a splash and soaks them in a scoop of unfiltered fun. Going deep for news and puns, I'm Carl Azuz. Sometimes a single picture can tell the story. And here's that story. Most pythons found in southern Florida are between 6 and 10 feet long. This female was more than 17 feet long. She weighed 140 pounds, and she was pregnant. with 73 developing eggs. Pythons are an invasive species in the region. They began showing up in Everglades National Park in the 1980s, probably from pet owners who didn't want them anymore. So they were willing to let pythons be bygones, but with so many snakes alive, they threatened to change the region's ecological history. One that big would make some folks jump out of their skin, while others would want to bifold it into a wallet or try it on for shoe size. Whether you'd want her constrictly gone or you'd leather alone, a snake that big is truly pythonic. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. For today's 10 out of 10 segment, firefighter dodgeball. Sounds like it'd be a pretty intense variation of the sport. But when they're fully suited up, there's more to it than just having to dodge, duck, dip, dive, and dodge. Firefighters from two New York departments were taking part in a drill to see how long their air cylinders last during a time of high activity. The answer ranged from 25 minutes to 51 minutes. The research wasn't as hotly contested as the game. Even if a burning spirit of competition flared up, at some point, both teams would run out of air and need a breather. Still, the question remains, did the losing team feel smoked, hosed, or just burned out? With firefighters, I guess it's always the latter. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. From land and sky to sea, the Mediterranean Sea, where a Turkish underwater research team found a shipwreck believed to be 3,600 years old. They think it was a merchant ship loaded with blocks of copper and that it sank in a storm while traveling to the island of Crete or possibly somewhere in the Aegean Sea. Turkish media say this could be the oldest shipwreck ever discovered. Some called the finding a breakthrough in underwater archaeology. Which sounds archaeological. The rudderly amazing find made a boom and a splash, generating a lot of hullabaloo and making researchers keel over with excitement. It's Jibs the thing to rope into our show before we port ways for the day, but we'll have ore to tiller you about tomorrow, so we hope you'll head sail back our way. For CNN 10, I'm Carl Azuz. If you live in bear country and you have a car, it's probably a good idea to keep your doors locked. The woman who owns this vehicle in Breckenridge, Colorado, would tell you that. It was parked, but apparently not locked up, and a bear, probably a small one, recently broke into the car one night and then proceeded to utterly destroy it. Maybe he thought it was his home because it was a Subaru Forester. The intruder did find something worthwhile in the back seat, a single package of gummy bears, which he also destroyed. Terrible, it's unbearable, but at least the video's shareable. An unlocked door near the forest floor makes for a cautionary parable. He had cause for it, he had claws for it. He smelled a sweet snack and had to pause for it. It shows how a bear is an animal, but does eating gummies make him a cannibal? Food for thought on CNN 10, and I'm Carl Azuz, hoping your weekend is bearific. Airports and waterfalls seem like two things that don't really go together. But they do at Singapore's Changi Airport. In its new $1.3 billion shopping complex, Changi has added an indoor forest complete with an indoor waterfall. It's more than 130 feet high, making it the tallest indoor waterfall on the planet. And what better place to put it than the airport that's been ranked the best in the world? Who needs a runway when you can have a spillway? Who needs a layover when you can have a sprayover? In the concourse of travel, when people get hangered up by delays that seem interminable, it's great to have a tower of water if the tower of control gets backed up. Maybe Changi will become a destination of its own for some folks who just don't want a departure. This is your Captain Carl Azuz, landing another edition of CNN. If you're into fast cars at all, meet the man who has your dream job. Raffaele De Simone gets to test drive Ferraris for a living, or as he puts it, to confirm that Ferraris are alive. He's also an engineer, but come on, dude gets to drive Ferraris. On the track, in the hills around Maranello, Italy, De Simone says driving one of these is a unique experience and that they're not only cars. That might be because they cost more than houses. But who wouldn't emotor about having whatever formula it takes to steer a career that's so aerodynamic? You can burn off fuel, tread, and calories if you have the inside line on drifting circuits all fast and Ferrarious. Who wouldn't want to push to start a career like that? I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Do Dubai, United Arab Emirates is a desert, so there's not much rain. But when there is, and it's accompanied by thunder, the Burj Khalifa, the world's tallest building, becomes a lightning rod. The massive jolts of electricity were diverted down to Earth. Nobody was hurt, but plenty of people shared video and pictures, including Dubai's crown prince. It's not just lightful, it's delightful. An illuminating jolt that brings both felicity and electricity. It sparks conversation and concern. It draws both a crowd and a cloud. It's a power trip that trips power, transforming transformers and bringing a shock to all who see it. I'm Carl Azuz, lighting up another edition of CNN. At first, this'll look like your run-of-the-mill pontoon boat hanging out on a lake. Nothing really unusual here. Until we zoom out. And now you see the problem. There was no one aboard the boat. No lives were threatened here. Officials believe that recent severe storms in the area caused the boat to break loose and drift to the edge of a dam. Once the weather calmed down, wildlife officers used an electric winch to pull the boat back to shore. All hands on deck to stop a shipwreck, to keep the boat afloat, a tack to stay intact. From bow to stern and from port to starboard, it's still seaworthy of being safely harbored. It was on the edge, hanging out in it deep, one waterfall away from being Poseidon's heap. But thanks to some maritime magic in a pinch, she sails again, tugged away by a winch. I'm your anchor, Carl Azuz, taking a bow for CNN. This probably isn't what most people think of when we say robots pulling a truck. But if you remember the four-legged creature-like Boston Dynamics robots, and you pictured 10 of them marching in unison while dragging something heavy, like some robotic sled dog army, then maybe you did have this in mind. Not everyone who saw this YouTube video was comfortable with it. Some call the fear of robots technophobia, some say it's robophobia. For anyone uneasy with the sight, it certainly instills some kind of phobia. The company says its robot dogs will be available soon. And wherever they're trucked in, whether they're transferred, road-trained, semi-autonomously wheeled somewhere, or if they have to be big-rigged up to something in tow, they could make a haul as long as nobody's dogged by the idea. I'm Carl Azuz, over and out for CNN. Today's 10 out of 10 segment concerns the world's slowest mammal. How slow is it? Well, in an average day, it only moves about 120 feet total. It's asleep for most of the time, and it's hanging out all of the time. And since 1992, there's been a sanctuary in Costa Rica dedicated to rescuing and rehabilitating this slothful creature.
Spidey. Well, hello, my sweet baby.
I'm Judy Avey Arroyo. I am the founder of the Sloth Sanctuary of Costa Rica. We rescue, rehabilitate, release, care for, research. We do everything sloth.
Miss Buttercup.
Our main goal, and this has always been our main goal, is for research. There's so much unknown about sloth. That's what I love about them, that everything that we're discovering is new stuff. The Sloth Sanctuary right now is caring for 214 sloths. We have reintroduced over the years 152. We have 16 babies in the NICU nursery. The rest are permanent residents. This is Stacy. Now, Stacy was brought by the firefighters. She had been burned by power lines, so she'll be a permanent resident. There are two completely different species of sloth. One is the bradipus. That is the three-fingered sloth, three fingers and three toes. The other species of sloth is the coloepus. He has three toes, two fingers. But they're prehistorically, they're not related. Sloths are energy efficient. Sloths are not lazy. Sloths have a very slow metabolism. What they're eating today could take up to 30 days to get through their system.
This is Buttercup. We call her the founder sloth. She's the sloth that started all of this crazy adventure.
I love sloths. My wish, my hope, my dream is to lift the sloths out of the darkness and let people know them and appreciate them and love them. And it's happening.
So are they slothful or just thoughtful? Maybe they're just philosophic. Slother them with questions, but you'll seldom see a sloth off topic. Hanging out or hanging in, they're not hung up when hanging round. Their caws or claws or escape claws is when they drop down to the ground. They're cut from different claws, the sloth. They sloth or sleep, then threaten you. Three toes or two, outsider in a zoo. Why would you eschew a baby sloth? Do, 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 do. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Gorilla selfie might make you picture an animal playing with a camera. In this case, the animals were posing for the camera. A park ranger in the Democratic Republic of Congo took this. He'd helped rescue the gorillas when they were babies. Virunga National Park says most primates are comfortable doing this for short periods of time. It hopes the picture's popularity will help with conservation efforts. The ranger wrote simply, "Another day at the office." A really, really good one. It's hard to feel lowland when you have gorillas stand up for you. They're willing to pose, but not pose a threat. They've gotten up on their own 2 feet. They're not trying to bamboozle anyone. In short, they look like they'd make prime mates. That's our stance on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. In part of Lincoln, California, thousands of sheep are typically brought in to chew up grassland before fire season begins. But when a neighboring resident opened his backyard gate to let his kids get a look,
oh, this is a huge mistake.
The sheep came a-running in. Now, there are worse things than having a yard full of ruminants. They're really only threatening the grass. But there were many of them, and for a while, they weren't going anywhere. Finally, when Scott Russo assumed the role of shepherd and led them back through the gate, while his wife jumped on the trampoline and shook a tambourine, the sheep retreated. Of course, the gate is now in sheep shape, and the shepherd broke a sweater to make them evacuate. It was like a floodgate to a bad bovid date. They went fleeting all while bleating in a pretty sheepish state. Is the grass greener? Well, we guess it all depends when a woolly, stubborn flock flocks to a residence. What a way to end a week. What a need to mend a fence. We are dropping sick bleats on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. A lot of kids with dogs know the animals only wish they could ride the school bus. Now they can. A man in Portland, Oregon offers a service that picks up pups in a custom van. He takes them to a large fenced-in pasture that's like this giant dog park for the day so they can run, play, and be dogs. And then he takes them back home. One difference between this and school recess, though, sometimes kids are allowed to join the animals on a play date. So in this case, the kids and the van have gone to the dogs. Wonder if the animals hound or pug their owners about this, barking about how they like staying home mastiff the time, but love their newfound land of recess and wish they could skipper key over Therrier more often pincher. From time to time, they gotta let out their Rottweiler side. I'm Carl Azuz, down making a barkload of puns for CNN. Yoga with baby goats. 10 out of 10. A person who took part in this said she figured it'd be, quote, yoga with goats running around. And that's pretty much what it was at this event in Kansas. Now, the animals do tend to get in the way, and that's all part of the fun. And a farm representative says your hair and clothes are at risk of getting a serious nibble. But if you don't mind a downward-facing goat with your downward-facing dog, then you'll probably want to namaste for more. You'll sub breathing for bleeding, posture for pasture, agility for futility. If this very idea gets your goat and you feel like you got a bad workout, hey, at least you'll have a scapegoat. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. Well, this is unlikely. At Ohio's Walnut Hills High School, 17 students recently got a perfect score on the ACT, a college admissions test. And the school says 23 more seniors were only 1 point away from a perfect score. So what? Well, according to the administrators of the test, out of the roughly 2 million students who take it every year, only 0.1% of them get a perfect score. So to have 17 perfect scores at one high school is nothing short of ACT-rific. They became number one with a number two pencil. They set a new standardized. The teachers had a multiple choice of students to congratulate. Just don't tell a competing exam they had a scholastic aptitude for it. That might test some nerves. I'm picking C and A for Carl Azuz on CNN. For 10 out of 10, Graham and Steve. Those are the names of two of the newest traffic reporters in the city of London. Yeah, this job's for the birds. According to Transport for London, these seagulls decided to perch in front of the traffic camera at, quote, beak times, giving an extra bird's eye view of conditions. This happened over the course of a couple days, and of course, it went viral thanks to the internets. Should have named them Jonathan and Livingston. It takes a lot of gall to wing a photobomb like that, but there are worse ways to spend a lurid day, even for the most gullible, and who wouldn't want to turn fishing for the chance to catch fame on camera? It's no red herring, and the outcome was simply unbelievable. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. When you think of getting cows to move, you might think of a herdsman on horseback or maybe a border collie on call. In the city of California, it was police who got the pleasure of herding a couple rogue cows recently, and the fun was caught on dash cam. It was a slow assignment right out of the gate. But what finer way to wander into the weekend? We could call it utterly ridiculous, say it was a milk run, tell you we know where the beef is, but before we hoof it, we'll just say we milked all the puns we could right up until the cows came home. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. The world's tallest dive coaster is now open for business, so buckle up and see if you can handle the suspense. This is what Canada's Wonderland theme park looks like from the Yukon Striker, a thrill ride that actually suspends riders for 3 seconds before they dive straight down. So you get a good gander at where you're going, and then you go there. The dive beneath an underwater tunnel is one part of it. The 4 inversions and 80 mile per hour top speed are others. A dive coaster is one that dives straight down. This is said to be the tallest, longest, and fastest dive coaster on the planet. So you won't find gold in them there hills, but if you don't mind the prospect of hitching up to a mine wagon that tunnels its way through stalactite twists and turns, it might not be an horrible idea to stake your claim on what could be the mother lode of all dive coasters. I'm Carl Azuz, mining puns for CNN 10. We've aired several reports from CNN's Dr. Sanjay Gupta on things people can do to help themselves live to age 100. Today, we've got a bit of advice from a man who actually did that.
They're looking at these phones and this to learn something and how to do something.
The words of George Morrow, who just celebrated his 100th year alongside his twin brother, James Morrow. The centenarian suggested that God had something to do with their longevity, and they advised that people always be honest and truthful. Though George says he feels just as good as he did at age 75, he said he'd rather live back when he was a kid. That would have been during the roaring 1920s. The secret to longevity is an age-old question. But their attitude about it was unflapperable, and it just makes centuries that to decades well, you've got to be good at shifting gears and years, whether you drive a Model T or a Model S, being a model citizen, and keeping good time and company as time goes by. I'm Carl Azuz. Turn another page in the calendar for CNN 10. Of course, the most famous NASA mission is probably Apollo 11, when American astronauts first flew to and then set foot on the moon. That happened on July 20th, 1969, making this year the 50th anniversary of the historic accomplishment. What sometimes gets overlooked, though, are NASA's other moon missions. There were several of them before the program wrapped up in 1972, and they provided history and humor all their own.
600 million people watched Neil Armstrong take those famous first steps on the moon.
It's one small step for man.
But after the Apollo 11 astronauts returned to Earth, public interest in later Apollo missions began to fade. But the people who continued to tune in were treated to some pretty special moments. Astronauts took advantage of their unique surroundings to have a bit of fun. During the Apollo 17 mission, Eugene Cernan and Harrison Schmitt sang their own rendition of The Fountain in the Park.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December. May.
The classic jumping photo. It may have been attempted at the last wedding you attended.
Come on out here and give me a salute.
Well, during the Apollo 16 mission, astronaut Charlie Duke captured John Young in midair while saluting to the flag.
Okay, here we go, a big one. Off the ground, about four. There we go.
It's since gone down as one of the most famous Apollo photos ever taken. When they weren't taking epic pictures, Duke and Young got to drive around in a lunar rover. The electric buggies were used on the last Apollo missions, 15, 16, and 17, and provided astronauts a fast way to cover large distances, helping them make more scientific discoveries than they could on foot, or just to do a bit of joyriding.
I thought the ride was real sporty. It bounced a lot. Sometimes both front wheels were off the surface. The back end is like driving on ice and breaking loose occasionally. But it was a lot of fun.
Back in the 16th century, Galileo taught his students that objects fall at the same rate regardless of their size or mass. That is, if they're not restricted by any resistance from the air.
Well, in my left hand I have a feather. In my right hand a hammer.
Well, since the moon has virtually no air to breathe, Apollo 15 commander David Scott decided to test this experiment by dropping a feather and a hammer from the same height. Lo and behold, they did in fact hit the ground at the same time.
How about that?
And just for a little fun, Alan Shepard brought the head of a six iron and a couple of golf balls aboard Apollo 14. The head was modified so he could attach it to an instrument that collected rock samples.
It should have gone probably on the Earth maybe 30, 35 yards. But that little rascal went over 200 yards with a one-hand shot like that, and it was in the air. The time of flight was almost 35 seconds.
Miles and miles and miles.
These lighter moments punctuated the main mission of scientific exploration. But perhaps the most enduring images are the ones when the astronauts actually looked back at Earth. This one taken on Apollo 17, the last time man was on the moon. It's known simply as the Blue Marble.
It's hard to get a pall over that truly Earth-tastic image. It makes you moony-eyed. It's like someone hung the moon and then made a world of difference by taking a picture from it. You can see why it stars on so moony posters. Sometimes a little space is all you need to see how beautiful the world can be. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. It's been said that when Bruce Banner gets mad, he turns into the Hulk. When the Hulk gets mad, he turns into Chuck Norris. And when Chuck Norris gets mad, run. Well, these people are a-runnin', and Chuck Norris is nearby. But the American action film star and martial artist wasn't mad. He was hosting a 5-kilometer run in College Station, Texas to benefit charity. Around 5,000 runners from the U.S. and abroad, many of them dressed as Chuck Norris, competed in the world's first Chuck Norris 5K. Standing at the finish line was the legend himself, and in addition to the high five he gave them, participants also got the chance to try to break the record for most Chuck Norris lookalikes in one place. As usual, the winner was Chuck Norris. Runner Walker, he's a Texas Ranger, and even with all those sidekicks, he's a Delta Force of one who'd never be missing in action because he's not expendable for that kind of event. I'm Carl Azuz, reporting for CNN, the Chuck Norris Network. Back in the 1920s, there was this fad called flagpole sitting. People would literally climb up on flagpoles and then just sit there, sometimes for days or weeks. Well, this happened Thursday morning in Florida. We're not sure exactly why the bobcat climbed to the top of an electric pole and then just sat there. but it was near a stretch of road called Alligator Alley, so maybe he was a scaredy cat. Anyway, there's not really a how-to manual on getting a bobcat off a pole, but a utility worker came along with a pole of his own, and after coaxing the cat a few times, the animal climbed down the same way he climbed up. Maybe firefighters can coax cats from trees, but it's not cat and dry when it's utilities. It'd be futility to try to simply seize a wild cat like he's a pet Siamese. It took cat-like reflexes and ambition for an animal to claw up to the pole position. But meow that he's down and safe as a kitten, they can say, scat cat, you ain't no electrician. I'm Carl Azuz, and Fridays are awesome. Hard to say if robots will one day win a battle of the bands. In this trio at China's Tsinghua University, the drummer has four arms, so that's an advantage. But while the flutist doesn't need to breathe, it's also unable to feel the music, becoming attuned to the nuances of the notes like humans can. The performance was arranged by teachers, graduates, and students, and timed to coincide with the university's 108th anniversary. So while some human musicians might see this as a troubling sign and seem a little downbeat at the thought of robots becoming majorly instrumental, striking a chord with concert audiences, people really ought to have nothing to fear. There's P&O way very har many machines have the same ensembleities as humans. They're more virtual than virtuoso. Creativity isn't their forte. Critics would say they're too robotic and may even sound symphony. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Maybe you've heard of gorillas in the mist? This video proves they don't like the rain. At least these gorillas don't. A zookeeper recorded this at the Riverbank Zoo in South Carolina. The animals are apparently under an awning, but where they really want to be is under their roof. After one of them makes the trip, it's not long before the others follow suit. For the primates in that climate, it's high time it got more dry. It makes them sigh if there's a giant storm so violent they revile it. Wonder why it won't be quiet. They could riot. They won't buy it. So to tie it up, just dry it up and give the ape a break. When the weather becomes wetter and you don't want helter-skelter, get a lean-to, get a tin roof, or Gorilla Glue a shelter. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. Some people think Starbucks is expensive. It ain't got nothing on this cup of coffee that's being sold at a coffee house in San Francisco, California. The place got hold of a coffee called Elita Geisha 803, a brew so elusive that only 100 pounds of it were recently sold at auction. A single cup costs $75, a pound costs $800. It is the most expensive coffee in the world, and it's said to taste smooth and like fruit. Of course, you could just eat fruit and avoid paying the coffee. Even some of the most fervent caffeines would lack the caffuns or feel like they'd been roasted when dripping a robusta sum of a latte dollars, all are because the beans were too Araricano to be spilled. Some may be pressed to macchiato more money and filter the funds to the coffee shop. Others would capacity no way for that to mocha sense. Woo! I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. We have a bit of a space odyssey for 10 out of 10 today. People have always had a fascination with the sky, but ever since humans went from only looking up to actually going up, the impact has gone well beyond science. It's affected our culture. So get ready to blast off on a retrospective of space and its influences on society.
I am your father.
For decades, space has been the ultimate source material. From music,
ground control to Major Tom,
to science fiction,
live long and prosper, image of Serac,
to video games.
Yeah, no way this is home.
But with the advent of NASA's Man in Space programs in the late 1950s, came unmistakably space-inspired architecture, pop culture, and trends.
Meet George Jetson.
But the astronauts do some things you do. In space, they drank Tang.
After astronaut John Glenn drank it in orbit, the powdered orange drink was launched into the public's consciousness, despite it having been on grocery shelves for 3 years.
Tastes great.
The space age fashion trend of the 60s was popularized by designers like André Courrèges and Paco Rabanne, Raban memorably designing the costumes for the 1968 cult film Barbarella, starring Jane Fonda. Then there were the missions themselves, dramatized into bestsellers and onto the big screen.
The Eagle has landed.
This is Houston. Say again, please.
Houston, we have a problem.
While the real-life pictures of the Apollo astronauts inspired some of the most iconic cultural images that endure to this day.
To infinity and beyond!
Makes sense that any time a rocket man or woman steps into a pair of moon boots and jetsons off to a galaxy far, far away, it would be the right stuff to barber elevate the imagination up all over the place, generating the kind of buzz that goes light years beyond drama to the known Atlas and making something oddity or alien come right down to Earth. I'm Carl Azuz, making space for puns on CNN. For 10 out of 10 today, a bar has been raised in the art world.
You have it, sir. $80 million.
That's 80 with a zero, and it works out to more than $91 million once you add the fees. That is the most money that a living artist's work has ever sold for at an auction. And this is the work, a stainless steel bunny inspired by a balloon toy. There were actually a few of these made. This was the last one that was held privately. The others are in museums. The name of Jeff Koons' sculpture? Rabbit. And that's not bunny money. It's a sum with more merit. And you'd think that for that fee, it would be 24 karat. It doesn't eat. It doesn't hop. Its ears ain't soft, and they ain't floppy. And it has no cottontail or coat or triplet sister Mopsy. Even certain multi-billionaires would hop away and never drop the price of a new island on a metal Hassan Pfeffer. But if you dare care for hair enough to spend like that, must be magic, pulling money like a rabbit from a hat. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10, and Fridays are awesome. If you have a fear of heights, you may want to look away, because we're stepping out onto what's said to be the longest suspension bridge in North America. It's called the Sky Bridge. It just opened in Tennessee. It's about the length of two football fields across, and at its highest point, it has a glass bottom, so you can see exactly what's 140 feet under your feet. You actually have to take a chairlift to get to the Sky Bridge. So if you're more acrophobic than acrobatic, your senses are more frightened than heightened, you'd rather be walking on home than walking on air, and you'd rather play Go Fish instead of bridge, this may be a bridge too far. But for Luke and the rest of us Skywalkers, we love spans that leave us in suspense. I'm Carl Azuz, traversing another edition of CNN. This is the kind of giant bear you wouldn't mind stumbling on. But honestly, what would you do with it? It's not going to fit in your room. It may not fit in your house. The new Guinness World Record holder for biggest teddy bear is more than 65 feet long. It weighs more than 4 tons. It took more than 3 months to sew together and more than 5 hours just to measure. It's meant to attract tourists to a town near Mexico City. And while a lot of people all can share it and others travel there just to stare, it's not gonna fit hardly anywhere. It just sits there as few rooms could bear it. Want one? Well, your home whereabouts better be a gigantic bear housing warehouse. Santa can't bring it. You'll need a quote from a shipping group that needs a bigger boat. If it stays afloat and seas ain't too heavy, you might just see your record-setting teddy. I'm Carl Azuz, stitching up another edition of CNN. Confirmed. Fire helmets can hold a maximum of 10 ducklings. That's a recent tweet from South Metro Fire Rescue in Littleton, Colorado, and here's how they know. A recent call came in saying that ducklings had gotten stuck in a storm drain. The mother was waddling anxiously nearby, but she had nothing to fear. Firemen worked together to retrieve the wayward babies, carefully carry them to a safe spot, and reunite them with their mother. They were quick to act. Their efforts fit the bill. They might have found it draining, but if they canvass back to the area, they'll find they made a teal difference, having had a golden eye for saving animals from a malady and not ducking out until everything was just ducky, y'all. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. Rising more than 1,800 feet above the capital of Seoul, Lotte World Tower is the tallest building in South Korea, and this is what it looks like all lit up. 30,000 1,000 firecrackers launched from 370 different locations made this giant candle burn. It took dozens of expert climbers about a month to set it all up, and it's the latest in a series of projects from Group F, a company that specializes in pyrotechnics displays. The theme of the project was peace, to reflect recent peace talks on the Korean Peninsula. Over the course of the 11-minute light show, $6 million worth of fireworks went up in smoke. So they literally had money to burn. And even if you don't want to be pyrotechnical about it, it was a towering achievement, a delightful accomplishment. They gave the fire the works, they had a blast, it was lit. And if you wanted to shine a spotlight on the event, you could say it took a Lotte lights, camera, and action. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. Navy Golden Retriever sounds like one too many colors, but not for Bud. He's a Golden Retriever who's in the U.S. Navy. In fact, of the Navy's more than 332,000 active duty staff members, Bud is the only Golden Retriever. And his job is to make sure that things that aren't allowed at Naval Station Norfolk aren't there. Usually it's German Shepherds that get jobs like this, but Bud's handlers say he does a great job and does it happily. That's why they have dogs do that work, to avoid bad catitudes. And Bud may be man's best, friendliest member of the military police. Even if he's a bit of a tattletale, he can sniff out crime, he can help fetch contraband, he's able to get Bart to the basics with a golden work ethic. In short, he's a doggone great choice for animal control of the base. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. Underwater. One of the places where you wouldn't want an Uber driver to take you, unless, of course, you ordered up a ride on the scuba. This costs more than a ride to work. It's over $2,000. But for that money, you get a car and helicopter ride to a mini submarine, and then you get a one-hour underwater tour of Australia's Great Barrier Reef. It's part of a partnership between Uber and an Australian state to promote tourism. So if you're in Australia and the price doesn't sink your budget, you may want to scuba up the opportunity to tour the Great Barrier Reef. It's a drive and a dive, a plunk for a plunge, a trip and a dip, and as long as you're not nervous below the surface, it could be the ride of your life that's uber memorable. I'm Carl Azuber for CNN. If a self-driving car brings a package to your driveway, it's apparently too hard for some people to go out to the driveway to get it. So the Ford Motor Company is testing this. The robot is called Digit. After packages are driven the last mile, Digit carries them the last 10 feet. And they say it can get around objects, though it may have to step on the grass to do it. Get off my lawn. How many human jobs will Digit replace? Does it work in the rain? What happens if a dog attacks it? What if Digit falls and can't get up? The questions are all relevant. Can Digit weather elements? Maybe he's someone's vision, but did they envision that he'd have to make decisions with precision if he's artificially intelligent? He's just a machine, after all. He can't get up after a fall. He has a mission and ambition, but if under bad conditions Digit undergoes a fission, it may take a good technician or maybe a good magician to mend him up if he ends up upended by a downfall. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Dierks Bentley isn't just the name of a country music artist, it's the name of a golden retriever. This golden retriever. And he's testing out the newest piece of equipment for a fire department in North Carolina. Oxygen masks for pets aim to help revive animals that have inhaled smoke, like in a house fire. And though each kit costs about $65, these were donated to the fire department by their local Humane Society. They come in different sizes, so they should fit Airedales, Labrador rib breathers, long air and short air cats, and guinea pigs, like guinea pigs, potentially saving oxygen generations of animals, giving both peace of mind and a breath of fresh air. I'm Carl Azuz. We have one more show to go in this season, and we hope you'll join us again tomorrow for Friday's awesome edition of CNN 10. Most people use video games for entertainment. Colorado high school student recently used Just Dance to devise a new method of conducting spinal surgery. The idea is that motion tracking technology could help a computer anticipate how a spine moves during surgery. The surgeon would then wear an augmented reality headset to see the images and do the work. This still needs testing, but it won the student $75,000 at a science fair. So the idea has backbone. Even if it's a little mind-bending and spine-bending, it's spellbinding. He was able to spinal tap into tech to vertebrate virtual reality with radiology to fuse a radiological solution, even if he had to bend over backwards to make it work. I'm Carl Azuz, on the loose for CNN 10. Thank you for our biggest year ever with our biggest audience ever. Thank you for your emails, tweets, visits, feedback, and requests. Have a wonderful summer ahead, and please join us again when CNN 10 returns on August 12th. For 10 out of 10 today, Louisville may be famous in part for the Kentucky Derby, but Chicago's got an annual Ducky Derby. More than 63,000 rubber duckies dumped into the Chicago River. That happened last week. This is a race. It costs $5 for a human participant to sponsor a duck. Proceeds go to support the Special Olympics, and if your duck is one of the first to float across the finish line, you could win a vacation, a wad of cash, or a new car! You'd feel pretty ducky. It'd be your ducky day if your float floats quackly and you're just $5 away from becoming one lucky duck. This is where we duck out for the day. I'm Carl Azuz. We're happy to have you watching CNN 10. A perfect follow-up to the rubber ducky race we told you about yesterday is the bathtub race we're telling you about today. 10 out of 10. This is one way that Moravia, New York honors America's 13th president. Millard Fillmore was born in Moravia, and he was said to be the first U.S. leader to install a bathtub in the White House. Now that's just a myth, but Moravia's modern bathtub races are 100% real. And they look like good, clean fun. They have a lot in common with the soapbox derby. They're bubbling with creativity, and for anyone willing to take the plunge, they're a good way to scrub up on racing skills without getting all tubsy-turvy with dirty tricks. I'm Carl Azuz, and we thank you for watching CNN.
New York.
Before the recent T-Rex race began in Nevada County, California, one thing was certain. There wouldn't be much pushing and shoving, because little arms. This is what it looks like when a bunch of first responders put on inflatable Tyrannosaurus costumes and take off at a county fair. It sure doesn't look like Jurassic Park, but in the end, an engineer from the fire department crossed the finish line first. Was it historic? It was prehistoric. Was it audacious? It was Cretaceous. And it couldn't have been that easy to facilitate, as at the tail end of the race, there were a couple Tyrannosaurus Rex. Still, there's no denying that everyone had a roarsome time, and we hope you did too, watching CNN 10. Unlike yours truly, not everyone in news wants to be on camera. Take, for instance, this burrowing owl. It's easy to see she ain't happy about reality TV. A hidden camera, which obviously wasn't hidden enough, was placed nearby the burrow to observe the animals in action. And even though these creatures only grow to weigh about a third of a pound, they're still strong enough to take out technology. We know what the camera operator said. Looks like owl will have to call tech support. We'll have to burrow their expertise to fix an owl function that occurred when a bird seed the camera and pushed it beak to a less frightening location. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10, and owl hope to see you tomorrow. People have written about walking on eggshells, air, sunshine. How about walking on glass? Hopefully not broken glass when it comes to this 1,800-foot-long walkway in southern China. It's a new part of a tourist attraction that also features scenic waterfalls and a restaurant in a cave, which stalagmite might be pretty good, if you know what I'm saying. The walkway cost about $1 million to build, in case you're thinking about putting one in your backyard. Even if you could foot the bill, it would be a jaunting task right out of the gate. You wouldn't want to ramble on too long once you got your marching orders. To keep pace and hit your stride, you'd have to be willing and amble to take steps to raise the money and stretch or even hike your budget for plans to crystallize and carriage the project across the finish line. But hey, at least you wouldn't have walked away from a challenge. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN. At age 103, Catherine Kitty Hodges said she was not nervous to jump out of a plane.
I'm all set.
Okay.
Whee!
Yes, she was. Three generations of her family were there to take the dive with her. And it looks like Kitty Hodges has set a new world record for oldest tandem skydiver. Part of her reason for doing this, She told King TV, quote, "It's fun, so why not have some fun? Hallelujah." Evidence of the jump has been submitted to Guinness World Records so they can verify that this is the record. Don't see how anyone could be contrarian to the centenarian. Some may be weighed down by the gravity of the idea, but Kitty seemed pretty well grounded, and after 103 years, we've all seen ups and downs. Why not take another to new heights? The very idea strikes a ripcord with a lot of people who wouldn't bail on bailing out to air out their soaring desire to fly. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. It's time to play Name That Fossil. Let's see. It measures a little over 7 inches. Experts say it's thousands of years old. It's kind of flat with ridges on the bottom. I know, it's a woolly mammoth tooth. That's what this is believed to be. It was discovered by a boy playing near a creek bed in Ohio. He found the fossil jutting out of the mud. He's hoping to get it back so he can show it off at school. But is this really a mammoth molar? I mean, it's so old, it's hard to know the tooth. Maybe an elephantine tooth fairy dropped it off after leaving a carrot under its pillow. That would have enamored scientists who didn't think it was just pulp. They'd crown the kid with getting to the root of an ancient mystery and making the mammother of all discoveries. I'm Carl Atooth for CNN. When air mattresses go airborne, 10 out of 10. At a Movie Under the Stars event in Colorado, people brought the air mattresses to relax on. But then a storm blew up, and a man swimming in a nearby pool said mattresses began blowing in over the fence. He grabbed his camera and captured what one observer called the Great Mattress Migration of 2019. What witnesses say looked like between 50 and 100 beds tumbling like tumbleweeds across the land. Glad he was able to interspring into action and keep an even temper with the material. It might make some plush, but you'd never get head bored of watching it. The video was framed well and made a dreamlike memory from the errant tumbleweeds. I'm Carl Azuz, laying down news and puns on CNN 10. After 50 years, the library director in Derry, New Hampshire decided it was time to finally crack open a time capsule. Would it contain film footage of what the town used to look like? Might it have memorabilia from astronaut Alan Shepard, who used to live here before he traveled into space? But no one expected it would contain absolutely nothing. Nada. Zilch. Well, maybe no one except the person who took it. It's possible that's what happened. It's also possible the capsule never contained a thing. Give them a second, or they might need a minute to spend an hour or a day thinking what might be in it. It's like breaking the bank only to draw a blank, an open and shut case making an about face when in place of keepsakes is nothing but space. How do you save face? Do you save the safe when its artifacts are hard to track, causing some heart attacks? Curious curator's interest turning on a dime when their city's storied history is simply lost to time. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. We've heard of cat cafes, dog cafes, even rabbit cafes, and this one looks pretty unusual just based on the art outside. But to actually share a cup of coffee with a raccoon, like a live, awake raccoon that you can pet, now that's something eye-opening. This business is in Ukraine. It's called Raccoon Cafe, of course. It features animals that have been socialized since they were babies, and it's so popular that the wait to get in is as long as half an hour. Now, some would not turn away from the very idea. It might not make a latte sense to have a cup of joe with a caffeine. Some would rather wear them than share with them, and that's a ring tale for another day. But if you raccooned resist the idea of making the mocha of an opportunity, one man's pest is another man's pleasure. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. For the elite athletes competing in the 2020 Summer Games, we present the medals, or at least a glimpse of what they'll look like. Around 5,000 of them will be made for the Tokyo Olympics. They'll feature Nike, the Greek goddess of victory, on the front, and the Tokyo 2020 logo on the back. What's unique about these is that they'll be made from the gold, silver, and bronze that's stripped from old electronics, including used cell phones. Now, we don't know who made that call, who voiced interest in what some would call a tonally golden idea, but it took more than a silver of creativity and could dial up a strengthened bronze between medalists. I'm Carl Azuz, wrapping up today's closing ceremony of CNN 10. Absolute loneliness and self-sufficiency. That might not sound like the ideal description of a 2.5 month vacation in the Pacific. On the other hand, that's what it took for Antonio De La Rosa to set a new record paddleboarding alone from San Francisco, California to Honolulu, Hawaii. He covered 2,900 miles to raise awareness about ocean pollution.
Aloha! Welcome to Hawaii! How are you doing?
This was Antonio De La Rosa's first contact with another human being since he paddled away from San Francisco on June 9th. The 42-year-old ultra-endurance athlete from Spain is the first person to cross the Pacific Ocean as a stand-up paddleboarder.
It's a record for me and for everybody.
He covered about 2,500 miles of open ocean using wind, currents, and elbow grease.
No motor. Only the motor is, this is the motor.
His vessel, the Ocean Defender, is a combo paddleboard and small boat with a sleeping cabin, storage bins, and solar panels for power.
GPS, one inside and one outside. Computer.
GoPro cameras documented his days and nights at sea. There was no escort vessel, so he was all alone. He estimates he lost about 10 pounds, but never got sick, despite very little sleep.
Every hour, I get up, checking the GPS, and checking the direction, moving the system.
Hurricane Flossie didn't hit him, but it did push him off course.
During 1 week, I was to the north, and I think, oof, what happened?
He once rode across the Atlantic Ocean. Now, he's conquered the Pacific.
Aloha, os espero Hawaii. Adios, amigos.
He surely wasn't up the creek, but without his paddle, the trip would have been horrible. We're not sure how he paddled boredom, but he seems like a stand-up guy. We're all aboat covering current events like that. There's just an ocean of punts abilities, and we hope you'll stand another show tomorrow when CNN 10 sets sail. I'm Carl Azuz. Noah Tingle is getting ready to graduate high school, so he's making the most of his time trying to embarrass his little brother. Whenever the bus drops off Max after school, Noah is there in costume. Firefighter, football player, Santa Claus, Indiana Jones, a sloth. What's become known online as the bus brother is just part of a big brother's way of making some fun memories before heading off to college next year. It's like sibling revelry. What better way to show slotherly love? When you're a costumer with an Indiana Jonesing to make a bus drop-off simply fantastic, unless you've got to gear up for a year-round Halloween. I'm Carl Azuz, and the bus stops here on CNN. Okay, what's fascinating about today's 10 out of 10 segment isn't so much what you're seeing, but where you're seeing it. These are innumerable pieces of pumice rock as recorded from a boat. What's being called a raft of floating pumice is the size of the New York City borough of Manhattan. And scientists believe it could be linked to the recent eruption of an underwater volcano in the South Pacific. Australian sailors say the rocks range from being the size of marbles to the size of basketballs. If the raft reaches Australia's Great Barrier Reef in the months ahead, it could bring new species there. It's the kind of scene to stun us, sailing stony seas of pumice, like a pebbled dock of floating rock that stretches out before us, waves of stone floating on seafoam, all because the glass is porous. It's volcanic, but don't panic, as the blasts beneath the surface that can help coral reef generate and serve a higher purpose than just giving us a sight to see, a sea that rolls and shocks and makes waves for making waves, showing that nature truly rocks. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. For 10 out of 10, it might have started with a handoff, but it's the footwork and handiwork of this Pee Wee League football running back that gets him to the end zone. Yes, that's a behind-the-back hand switch. And in case you missed it, boom, there's another. The defense had no idea how to stop him. And like the kid himself, the video went from the 50-yard line in Pennsylvania and scored, getting coverage on National Network Sports News. So there's been a media blitz on that clip, and critics might say that after that fumbling halfback effort, the defense needs to huddle and gridiron out its man-to-man coverage when it's going toe-to-toe with a pocket-sized carrier who turns on a dime. It's fourth down at CNN 10, y'all. I'm Carl Azuz. We will be off the air Monday for the Labor Day holiday, so we'll join you again next Tuesday right here. Out of 10, some football fans settle for pennants or jerseys. A guy in Oklahoma named Owen built a replica of Owen Field in his backyard. It used to be a pasture. Now it's 1/10 the size and almost all the look of the home of the Oklahoma University Sooners. It took months for Owen Pickard and his family to finish the project. He says it also took months for him to get permission to build it from his wife. He's probably owing her a debt of gratitude for being game and letting him carry the project to the end zone. And hopefully the neighbors don't pile on and say this is out of bounds. We're sure Owen had to field a lot of questions about his field of dreams, and that may be why he didn't build it sooner. I'm Carl Azuz, and we're ending this game at the CNN 10-yard line, y'all. 'Here in the news studio, there aren't too many occupational hazards, besides the light reflector I sometimes bump my head on, or the bloopers I say but you never see because we edit those out. In the field, it's a different story. News producers are out in the elements, keeping up with newsmakers, ducking, dipping, sometimes slipping, even on occasion, tripping.
You see all those feet coming towards you, except for a couple of pairs facing the wrong way? That is known in the TV news biz as backpedaling. It's what a camera person does when a candidate is on the move, and the faster they move, the more likely this is to happen. The guy it happened to, CNN's DJ Judd, shrugged it off. He was unhurt, and his camera?
My gear is fine, my dignity not so much.
Here's what it looked like from DJ's point of view.
There goes your streak.
That's candidate Pete Buttigieg noting the end of DJ's no-fall streak. Watch this guy tear by Buttigieg to get in front of him and then wipe out.
Look, I'm walking!
Here's the replay of him zipping by from another angle. Instantly back on his feet. Backpedaling isn't confined to news. There was the time the Alabama Crimson Tide flooded the field and a sports photog bit the dust. Of course, a camera person doesn't have to be going backwards to fall.
But rather, it is some black ice, which at times can be a very slippery thing, let me tell you.
Critics might pan a cameraman who slips, or boo when boom goes the camera jibs. They might crane their neck or tilt their heads back if a folly with the dolly gets everything off track. But someone's got to shoot it if you're ever going to see it, so don't make light of their plight when they TV it. Their eyes and ears wherever news is handled in, ready if not steady, must always be the cameraman. I'm Carl Azuz, focused and zoomed in on CNN. If you're staying inside a lodge, you'd think you'd be protected from some of the wildlife that prowls around outside. It's not exactly how it went recently at a lodge in Big Sky, Montana. A black bear made its way inside the ladies' bathroom and then decided to take a nap on the sink. The lodge says the animal got in through a window. Police and wildlife officials were able to tranquilize the bear and then move it to a more appropriate location. Were the bears welcome? There were no signs that said so, and taking naps outside gives them much more restroom, so that's something to think about. The story generated some major interest, but no injuries were brought to bear, so the officers deserve some serious Cody accolades. I'm Carl Azuz. Thanks for bearing with me on CNN 10. We don't know how much tin it took to build this massive machine, but you probably don't want to fight it. A Japanese robotics company developed this over about 6 years. It's named Mononofu, which means samurai warrior. It's modeled after machines in Japanese animation. It's 27 feet 9 inches tall, and it actually can't get out of its warehouse unless you take off its head first. This is the Guinness World Record for largest humanoid vehicle. Maybe smaller machines would be humanoid by its existence, but they'd be mono no foolish to engineer an altercation. We're not Decepticoning you when we say the Omega Supreme achievement that takes up some Optimus Prime real estate is all about to be truly transformative for an industry that's already built on nuts and Voltrons. The competition is just going to have to go back to the drawing board, y'all. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10, and Friday's awesome. Here's a court case that's for the birds. Maurice the rooster crows at dawn. A couple that owns a vacation home nearby want to sleep in. They accused Maurice of noise pollution and requested that he be put inside at night so he doesn't crow in the morning. The rooster's owner says the complaining couple would not negotiate. Well, a court in France decided in favor of Maurice and fined the complaining neighbors $1,100 in damages. Could they appeal? I don't know. They might be too chicken. They cried uncle, but the rooster didn't care uncle. They could take their house to market, but the crowing could affect its more resale. They can talk a doodle-doo about it, but they pecked a fight and lost. So what else is there to do but cry in your cornflakes at dawn? I'm Carl Aroost for CNN. It's a bird. It's a plane. It's a motorhome. It's a shed. And if you think that sounds like no ordinary shed, you're right. This garden storage unit on four wheels is powered by a 4.2 liter V8, and it's capable of going faster than 80 miles per hour. So why would someone build this and then put 34,000 miles on it? Well, it did set a Guinness World Record for fastest garden shed. So if you need to get your tools fast, wheel barrel through traffic, or test the limits of spade, don't throw in the trowel. Hop in the speed shed and rake in a record for hose power while leaving your competition in sheer defeat at a dusty fork in the road. I'm Carl Azuz, planting and pruning puns on CNN 10. In surfing, people can hang 10, that's 10 toes, off the front of certain longboards. But only dogs can hang 20. This happened at the 14th annual Surf Dog Surfathon at a dog beach in California. More than 70 dogs surfed, in costume, at a fundraising event for a local animal care center. The top dogs, the best canine surfers, were judged on everything from ride length and confidence to how happy they looked while surfing. Seems like the Portuguese water dog will be good at that, not to mention the Surferian Husky or the Chinese Wave Crested. The Wave Marider should be able to surf with Maltese, and the Berger Picard could catch some serious Airedales. Seems like the Border Collie, though, would be the most sure thing. I'm Carl Azuz. Thanks for hanging, CNN. Hey, Carl.
Yeah.
Heard you're going on a cruise this winter.
Uh-huh.
Where are you headed?
Space.
That's the kind of conversation envisioned by the company that designed this. It's a cruise ship-style space station that would orbit the Earth and act as a space port for researchers, astronauts, and tourists on their way to and from Earth. This is just a design at this point. You can't go there now. The company that created it wants it up and running by 2027. Sure, the accommodations will be out of this world, the beds like sleeping on a cloud, the experience like walking on air, the service otherworldly, the reservations waitlisted, and the view the best off Earth. But you should definitely call on a satellite phone before you blast off and check in, because the cost could be astronomical, y'all. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. At Indiana's Purdue University, there's a new delivery team on campus. They don't talk much, but they do bring students something to chew on. Customers can order food and drinks using a smartphone app. The meals are plopped into the robots, which then zip around and drop them off within minutes. They're automated, though the people who monitor them can take control if needed, and the company that provides the service hopes to expand it in the years ahead. The question is, will the meals on wheels be slow in the snow? Will they beat the heat with the food you eat, or will they arrive at all if the leaves and fall mire the tires and cause impairments that need repairments? Guess the robots will have to learn the per-dos and don'ts of drone livery. I'm Carl Azuz, delivering another edition of CNN. For 10 out of 10, buckle up and don't blink. What you didn't just see right there was a sled, a U.S. Air Force test vehicle that was traveling along the rails of Holloman Air Force Base at around 6,599 miles per hour. That makes it hypersonic, meaning faster than 5 times the speed of sound. It's part of an Air Force effort to develop vehicles and materials that are capable of withstanding extraordinary speed and acceleration. Which mocks it, a moxing that anyone could mock something so fast. It's like the project has gone off the rails even if it stays on them. A hyped up hypersonic sleigh that's faster than a speeding hedgehog and more powerful than a burning rosebud. Citizen Kane, you believe it? It's like cinematic cinemagic on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. Before we bounce, we'd like to draw your CNN attention to an inflatable castle that would make the ultimate party rental for a super sweet 16. This is the biggest bounce house on Earth. It covers 10,000 square feet, which makes it more than 4 times bigger than the average American home. Inside, you'll find everything from a basketball court and a ball pit to an obstacle course and a dance stage. Of course, if gravity's weighing you down, this can help you rebound by putting spring in every step along your moonwalk on an inflatable estate that's an undeniable escape where you'll be walking on air right where you want to jump as the king of a castle that has its very own fan club, assuming the $25 ticket fee doesn't completely deflate your wallet. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. Waffles and Hemingway. Sounds like an art film no one wants to see. It's actually the name of this pair. Waffles is the miniature horse and Hemingway's the goose. They were rescued from a property in bad shape a couple months ago. Since then, they've been inseparable, and that could have been a problem for a farm looking to adopt only one of them. Well, a new owner was found, and both Waffles and Hemingway get to stay together at their new home. So thankfully, no one waffled on the decision to give them a Hemingway to stay friends, because whether they're horsing around or goosing up their stable, they have a honkin' good time with the main man and the spruced goose singing along in the barnyard, staying true to farm and being good for the gander. I'm Carla Goose, out of puns and out of time on CNN 10. And here is what a penny farthing looks like. It's also known as a high wheel bicycle for obvious reasons. It appeared on the scene around the year 1870, and historians believe it led to the invention of the unicycle, because why not leave the relative safety of 2 wheels for just one? If keeping balance while mountain biking is more challenging than road biking, let's turn 10 out of 10 up to 11 and go off-roading on a mountain unicycle. Well, he spoke of some really interesting points, if not universal ones. It's hard to switch gears and can even grind your gears if you know you've only got one, and not everyone would peddle the idea of taking a seat where a wheelie is the only way to ride. You're only keeping it half as wheel as a bicycle. Still, as we ride off into the sunset for the week, we hope you'll keep it in the road, even if you go off-road, and we thank you for keeping CNN 10 your number one for news. I'm Carl Azuz.
So.
For 10 out of 10 today, if you think the best place for yellowfin tuna is on a sushi roll, some engineers at the University of Virginia disagree. They built this. They're calling it a tuna bot because it's vaguely shaped like the fish, but with no fins except for the tail, and it can swim about 3 feet per second. But why? Researchers want to study the physics of how fish swim, and their work could be used to help develop new underwater vehicles. They could have called it GoFish. It's surely not a glowfish. It's a souped-up, tuned-up, mechanized robofish. Wicked tuna in disguise is a sight for sore sock eyes. It barracuda lend a golden perch to more in-depth grouper research, bullheaded in its purpose to go trout beneath the surface. Holy mackerel to its albacore, it trumpeters terrific. A bonito bream of research from Atlantic to Pacific. It makes fish story his story, reeling in our show. I'm Carl Azuz, casting lines, and it's time for us to go. Holy history, Batman! The third Saturday in September, which was last weekend, is known as Batman Day. And since it was the 80th such Batman Day, marking 80 years since Batman first appeared in a DC comic book, fans who take their fiction seriously got up, dressed up, and turned out to see the bat signal flashed in more than 12 cities worldwide. Not sure what else they did, but for bat fans, costumes old and new were all part of the fun. The Caped Crusader capers are a graphic novel idea, even if they seem kind of comical, but they're nothing to whine about. What kind of Joker would want to play spoiler to Bat fans by robbing them of DCing and being seen in the dark of night? It's a two-faced prospect where no one penguins. I'm Carl Azuz, solving the riddler of puns on CNN. The eBay description alone is a 10 out of 10. 15-ton, two-story-tall, gasoline-powered, car-smashing, piloted giant battle robot. It's used and has dents and dings from robot combat. It cost $2.5 million to build and was listed for only a dollar, though bidding was at more than $50,000 last night. Now the downsides. It'll probably cost $2,500 in gas, repairs, and maintenance every time you use it. It needs new treads. Shipping ain't free. And the company that made it is bankrupt, so no returns. You'll need a machine works to ensure the machine works. You'll need some megabucks to buy the megabot. But for robot fans, it's a sight for sore mechan eyes. It puts the fun in functional, can yield tons of it, powering up a hydraulicking good time, at least until you have to repair to a shop, because if you ro-break it, you robot it, and its service will be limited when it needs it. I'm Carl Azuz, and that is CNN 10. We're doing a little trolling on 10 out of 10 today. Imagine walking through a park in Belgium on the hunt for hidden trolls. They can't be too hard to find. They stand between 13 and 26 feet tall, and they were a gift from a Danish artist to a park that hosts a famous music festival. They're all made out of recycled wood, and there are seven of them lying around or sitting around or toting buckets next to ponds. Unless you're looking to be gobbling up some time on an unusual troglodyte, you might have to overcome your troll phobia, getting some self-elf before spending time with gnome sweet gnome at such a kobold destination. Still, it makes for a fairy tale ending to CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. Summer may have officially ended on Monday, but in many parts of the world, it's still warm enough to do this. And in Malaysia, it's always warm enough to take a ride on the world's longest inner tube water slide. It just received the Guinness World Record. It's more than 3,600 feet long, which is approaching 3/4 of a mile. You take a cable car chairlift to get to the top, and it takes 4 minutes to get from start to finish. You could watch part of a movie in that amount of time. Consider Slider Man, Slide as in Kane, In Slide Out, Slideways, The Slider House Rules, Slide and Prejudice, The Slide of the Yankees, Seven Slides for Seven Brothers, West Slide Story, His Girl Slide Day, Bonnie and Slide, and of course, there's also The Shape of Water, Waterbirds, Gravity, and Jaws, which would make for one exciting trip. I'm Carl Azuz. Have a great weekend from all of us here at CNN. It is one thing to move to a historic home. It's another thing to move a historic home. That's what's happening here after the buyer of a 255-year-old mansion in Maryland relocated it 50 miles away. It was built to last and to float. We don't know how much the house was built for, but it was sold recently for $500,000, obviously plus moving expenses. The new owner says he plans to restore it and give it to his parents, who shouldn't mind if their son barges in because the house has been barged on. That could have been featured on Beachfront Barge on Hunt. Gives new meaning to waterfront real estate, making you feel like you're on the river because you're on the river. And while some historic homes are remarkable for still standing, this one's moving and sailing, and it brings us home sweet home on CNN. For 10 out of 10, why sit around like a bump on a log when you can roll one under your feet across the Mississippi River? That's what Alyssa Weatherby thought, and last Thursday, the professional timber sports athlete did it, rolling and floating on a synthetic log from Port Byron, Illinois to LeClaire, Iowa. Weatherby is said to be the first person ever to do this, and her husband says she's a great role model. We may not know how much wood would a woodchuck log if a woodchuck would log roll, but try as it maple, it could only pine away for the kind of record Alyssa set as she plied her trade, spinning from beach to beach while keeping her sea legs all aboard. I'm Carl Azuz, sprucing up another edition of CNN 10. Is an octopus able to dream? I'm sure you've asked yourself this question many times, and this video may have the answer. It's from an upcoming PBS program on octopi. The animals are able to change their skin color when they're trying to escape predators or be them, and this one was recorded changing color in its sleep. So a marine biologist says this might indicate that the eight-armed mollusk was dreaming. But what was it dreaming about? Oysters on the half shell, an eight-legged race, watching a cephalopodcast? There are a plank ton of possibilities here, and we're not going to invertebrate them or octopile on criticism. When an octopus dreams, y'all, the sea's the limit. I'd like to write more puns about it, but I'm out of ink. This is Carl Azuz for CNN. For Cade Lovell, a 9-year-old from Minnesota, it was just another 5-kilometer race until it wasn't. A volunteer told him to go the wrong way, and the fourth grader soon found himself on a 10K course surrounded by adults. But he made up his mind to complete the race. And though his mother, who was waiting at the 5K finish, was worried sick, her fear turned to pride when Cade not only finished the longer course, he actually won the 10K race. His Nikes to victory? To be a champion, you gotta get Reebok to Asics. Puma making the best effort, Ms. You-Know-How, even if that means finding a new balance or having to sketch her out a new route. You gotta make an Adidas for the finish, even when you don't feel like it. I'm Carl Azuz, making conversation on CNN 10. Well, this looks like a yacht of fun. It's a yacht, or at least a computer design of one. And though there aren't immediate plans to actually build this, it would be unique in that it would be the world's first super yacht powered by hydrogen. That could make it more environmentally friendly. It could also be more expensive to run. But then again, it's a yacht, so money. Its developers say it'd be 367 feet long and capable of sailing as far as 3,750 nautical miles with a top speed of 17 knots. Its name? Aqua. Other sailors might keel over with envy when they see you hauled in the next hydrogeneration of boat. They might not sink much of your fuel source and give you stern looks while saying diesel not work for everyone. Or they might sail it as something of great import, bowing with respect at your catamaranser. I guess whether they jib you about it or helm you extol its virtues depends on the tack they take. And of course, whatever floats your boat. I'm Carl Azuz, your anchor for CNN 10, and Fridays are awesome. Lamborghini Aventador. Unless you find one on sale for, like, say, 97% off, you won't find one for $20,000. But that's how much a father and son say they've spent building this one. The dad is a physicist who works with lasers. That probably helped in the 3D printing of the car's pieces, which were then glued together. It has a Corvette engine, and it could be finished after 2 years of work. They hope it'll get others interested in engineering. Maybe one day they'll drive it, or one day they'll dread it. But even if it's not real, you gotta Lamborghini give them credit. 3D printing a car may seem a little quixotic, but it's a whole new third dimension of exotic. You can get Gallardo power from an LS or a Hemi, and you'll have a Miura image of a lightning Lamborghini. It brings the cost down to something more affordable, a carbon fiber copy that's avent adorable. I'm Carl Azuz, on the loose for CNN. In keeping with our art theme, we present to you pumpkin carving underwater because it's autumn in the Florida Keys. This was a competition among dozens of artists who worked in teams of two to carve out their best jack-o'-lanterns. The prize was a free dive trip in Key Largo, and this might be harder than you think because pumpkins are naturally buoyant, so the carvers had to keep them from floating away while they worked. It's not always easy to scuba out a pumpkin, and if your skill set doesn't stem from deep-seated creativity, you gotta be careful not to get waterlogged with frustration and just flip your lid. You just take a deep breath, dig in, and carve out something knifey, you'll be sure to do a really good job. I'm Carvel Azuz for CNN 10. Ten out of ten goes to the marching band and color guard of Corona del Sol High School in Tempe, Arizona, for illustrating how the show must go on even when the sprinklers do. This happened when they were in the middle of their halftime show. But what won the crowd and national news coverage was their determination to soldier on until the sprinklers were finally turned off. After that, they took it from the top without missing a beat. Well, that's certainly not in the drill book. Those students could have easily disbanded, gotten brassed off, had some drum major issues, faced plumes of problems, or dropped their color guard and marched off on a bad note. But by sheer determined instrumentation, they showed nothing could stop them, even if it rained on their parade. That's all for CNN 10. I'm Coral Azuz. We've heard of turbochargers, superchargers, nitrous oxide, but what this car has under the hood is nuts. Walnuts. After hearing noises and smelling burning, the woman who owns this SUV looked under the hood and found that squirrels apparently stored 200 walnuts right there, along with some grass. Took about an hour to clean everything out, but the car was fine. Of course, it could probably cash use a tune-up. It may be pistachio overdue for an oil change. You should always check the filbert and make sure you concede that everything else is pine. You don't need to be a master macadamiac to make sure your engine is running like butternut. I'm Carl Azuz, driven to make puns on CNN. A Canadian fire department recently ordered 18 large pizzas for $300. They thought they'd called Alimo's Pizzeria in Alberta, Canada, where they're based, but instead they'd ordered from Alamo's Pizza in San Antonio, Texas. Oops. That's 2,300 miles away, so a bit far for delivery. So what they decided to do was donate the pizzas to two local fire stations in Texas. Firefighters there shared some pictures of themselves enjoying the pies, and now people from all over are donating pizzas to workers. Who wouldn't want a pizza that effort? For anyone in pepperoni need of a pick-me-up, these pizzas are making the rounds where slices of goodwill abound, and folks don't want to miss the chance to dish out a gesture whose ingredients are kindness and generosity and is never too cheesy to pie it forward. I'm Carl Azuz. Hope your weekend is fresh. A stealthy lion sneak attack gets a 10 out of 10, but don't worry, we're not going to show you something getting eaten. Unless you count a snippet of fur, maybe, from Mama Lion's back. She's watching two of her cubs amble in straw at the Scottish Zoo when, bam, the third baby, the troublemaker, takes a bite. Thankfully, Mama doesn't overreact or take revenge, because if she had and we had told you the video wasn't violence, well, we would have been lion. Or at least kitten around. Our critics would have pounced. Sometimes they do that just because. But all agree there's something roarable about a sneak attack. It's just a main thing to do. I'm Carl Azuz, and that is CNN. At an assisted living center in Texas, a group of senior citizens said they missed giving out candy on Halloween. So they took to social media to ask their community to send in candy and to let the local kids know their home was a safe and fun place to trick-or-treat. Well, the candy has come pouring in, and the seniors are hoping all of the kids in the surrounding neighborhood come knocking at their door in just over 2 weeks. If we were just a tweezle bit closer, I'd totally pop in. Sure, there might be some snickers at an older kid, star bursting through the door like some giant nerd or Jolly Rancher. Some might want to gobstop me in my tracks or tell me to skittle-daddle. But that would only cause musketeers, when all I'd want is to walk a Milky Way full of almond joy with my butterfingers clasped around a whole chocolate of sugar. I'm Carl Azuz, and that is CNN. Ships have been squeezing through Greece's Corinth Canal since 1893. Its rocky walls are about 82 feet apart. This cruise ship is about 74 feet wide. That means it had just 4 feet on each side to spare as it recently squeaked through the canal and reportedly set a new world record. The boat is about 642 feet long. It's not huge for a cruise ship, but it is for this canal, and it recently made the passage with 929 passengers on board. Of course, if it had gotten stuck, all ships have bridges, and if that didn't boat well and the passengers became starboard of waiting, they wanted to galeave, and there was no gangway to depart from the sides, there'd be no need to be stern. You can just muster your courage and start rock climbing. That'll keep your itinerary. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. If NASA succeeds in returning astronauts to the moon in 2024, here's a look at what they'll be wearing. The agency unveiled two very different looks recently. The white one is designed for when space travelers go outside to bounce along the moon's south pole. The orange one is what they'll wear when launching into space and returning to Earth. NASA says the suits will give astronauts more mobility, though you can see it's still more limited than, say, a business suit. They'll be more expensive, too. The originals cost around $22 million. Now, some might have a Prada with that. They or may think that Lacoste is Burberry expensive. But not that Armani spacesuits will be made, and if these are just the first and beginning of a cline of common space projects, who's to say they go to yay extremes when there's a ton of possibilities in interstellar fashion? I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Anyone with $200 could buy a Barbie dream house, but for $120 plus taxes and fees, you could rent this one where the dream has come true. It's life-sized. The infinity pool, the fashionable clothing, the Malibu address, the cornucopia of pink, it's all real. And it's available for only one lucky renter and his or her guests who will get it for two nights at just $60 per night. It commemorates Barbie's 60th birthday. Could you be the one to skip her over there to celebrate? Stacy in style, enjoy the Francie decor, jazzy it up, and have a truly model stay in something so adorable? Yes. Yes, you can. And we hope you'll Barbie here again next week with CNN 10 Returns. I'm Carl Azuz. There's a new resident at the Paris Zoological Park. See if you can guess what it is. It can grow as fast as 1.5 inches per hour. It has no mouth, but it likes to eat bark and oatmeal. It has no brain, but scientists say it can communicate and solve problems, and it's not an animal, a mushroom, or a plant. Give up? It's a blob, a slime mold. We don't expect it to be the most exciting organism at the zoo, because after all, it's not really a fun guy, and watching it tends to get mold after a while. But when it's excited, it can blob a lot. When it's sad, we bet it blobbers. And we hear it likes movies like The Blob, The Green Slime, and Ghostbusters, though it always roots for Slimer. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10, and it's just too bad we're all out of slime today. If you've ever wondered why someone would pay to be terrified by creepy clowns at a haunted house, at least this one comes with a car wash. It's a haunted car wash in Brunswick, Ohio. For $20, you get a trick-or-treat bag, sheer terror, and an air freshener to help afterward. And even though the little kids may never be the same if you drive through a tunnel, at least the outside of your car will be clean. A little clowning around when the water comes down, along with the wax, you fear the attacks of the workers who are lurkers and makeup and masks bringing fears and tears and jeers as drivers pass. It's where car care looks like car scare, making you wince with the rinse, leave tread with your dread, and never want to steer back through the ghostly scene thinking your scarred car is better left unclean. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Following yesterday's Halloween-themed 10 out of 10 segment, you've heard of The Walking Dead? Take a ride with the Biking Dead. What else would you expect at the Florida Keys Fantasy Fest Zombie Bike Ride? This is part of a 10-day festival that takes place every year. There's a lot of makeup, a lot of creativity that goes into this, and not much speed, so you can get a good gander at the 11,000 undead people who participated. And there's no place they'd rather zombie. Now, it might not look too real, but it is two-wheeled. A zombie, a bikealypse that's a ride of the living dead. For some, it's killer. For others, it's thriller. And haters can just hoist up the zombie sail and go home to another zombie land. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. We're calling time on 10 out of 10 today. There are TV timeouts, replay timeouts, injury timeouts. And in Montana, there are tumbleweed timeouts, or at least there was at a recent women's soccer game between Helena High School and Kalispell Flathead. Some of the players posed with it. A referee eventually grabbed it. Not much else you can do about it other than to let it keep rolling along, drifting along with the tumbling tumbleweeds. That's a musical reference no one will get. But tumbleweeds roll to their own amaranthum, really. They're not rooted in anything, at least not anymore. They branched out without a place to plant themselves. They blow thistle away and that, tumbling as fast as the wind and causing timeouts in soccer and on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. Last month, we told you how scientists said they'd taught rats to play hide and seek. Can rats be taught to drive? They can't reach the pedals in a Ford pickup. But in a University of Richmond study, they were taught to drive these ROVs, that's rat-operated vehicles. Their reward was Fruit Loops, and they were found to be better drivers if they'd been raised in a more stimulating environment, like a cage with toys, as opposed to a boring lab cage without them. The lab cage rats reportedly failed their driving course. They were accused of breaking the law by tailgating. They had squeaky brakes, they never yielded the rat away, they always drove over the maximum speed limit, and they struggled making rat turns. Seems the researchers ratted them out, and now they'll never pass the driver's test. I'm Carl Azuz. Have a great weekend from all of us here at CNN. For 10 out of 10, pumpkins float, but will they float your boat? They will if you're this man. He's a farmer in Tennessee who took a 910-pound pumpkin, carved it, and set sail. His name's Justin Ownby, and this is the biggest gourd he's ever grown. His previous record was a 220-pound pumpkin. So he's definitely making progress, but he hopes that one day, maybe as soon as next year, he'll achieve a 1,000-pounder. We think he's doing just fine. You can see the gourd job he's doing stems from a fruitful desire to pick and patch together his own record, and hopefully his lantern will light up soon enough. I'm Carl Azuz, growing a few pumpkins on CNN. Sure, there are a lot of satellites, but it's not like they just fall out of the sky. Here's what a couple in Michigan found in their yard last weekend. It appears to be Samsung's Space Selfie Satellite, a stunt that was intended to allow people to get their face in space. It was also intended to be up there until the end of the month, but Samsung says weather conditions resulted in a, quote, early soft landing. The Michigan couple was thankful their horses weren't out and that it didn't hit their house. And they said the satellite's smartphone was still working, so at least that's not a total piece of space junk. Also, it survived the dropped out of the sky test. After a not-so-satellite landing, it could have been in ore bits and pieces, and at least they know where it came from, so they didn't have to investigate them selfies. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's CNN 10. A friend of mine from college had this theory that the world was turning to lint, starting with what's in our dryers. I'm not saying this is proof, but it was collected from dryers across the country to form a 690-pound ball of lint. Why? Great question. A dryer repair company wanted to set a new world record and to raise awareness about the importance of cleaning lint from our dryers, because it's flammable, as setting it on fire clearly showed. You could say it sparked up like flint, a fire from a fiber, a flashing glint of lint. What started as threads unraveled into shreds? What started as a yarn was quick to burn? Does it seem off-kilter to take a dryer filter and then clean it just to gleam it for a demonstration? It's a strange conflagration that lights conversation and concludes today's displays on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azuz. Apparently, even galaxies far, far away aren't immune to Halloween hoopla. Is it an alien? C-3PO? The Iron Giant? No, silly. Scientists say it's two galaxies of equal proportion involved in a head-on collision 704 million light-years away from Earth. Of course! The eerie image was captured by the Hubble Space Telescope in June. And get a good look while you can, because scientists say this will only be visible for 100 billion more years. It's a sight to galaxy, a distant fright that space can't flee. Its eyes leave you incredulous, even if its cause seems nebulous. It's more star fright than fighter, a stellar collider. Run and hider! Good thing there are light years between the space face and us this Halloween. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN Tech. Mom didn't have to tell me not to play baseball inside because, well, smash. That's the very same reason why this seems like it might not be the best idea. But it's not like you could just step outside to play on the International Space Station, and the ball travels farther in microgravity. So if astronauts Jessica Meir, Christina Cook, and Andrew Morgan can't attend the World Series, maybe they can just very carefully see how this plays out. Of course, if they're all Astros fans, the real thing wouldn't have been a washing ton of fun for them. But who needs baseball when you've got spaceball? Who needs to knock one out of the park when you're already out of the atmosphere? Without gravity, there are no infield flies, no sinkers, no grounders, yet every game is an out-of-this-world series. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. While bow hunting from his kayak in Michigan's Grand River, an outdoor sportsman recently came across an old Coke bottle and thought it was litter. On closer inspection, though, he found a message in the bottle dated April 4th, 1976. It had a name and an address on it, and more than 43 years after Troy Brayman tossed it into the water, he got his response on Facebook. The sender and the finder of the message found they have a lot in common. Of course, after so many years had floated by, the nostalgia might have left the sender a little glassy-eyed, but it shows how time is a bridge between past and present, and a river runs through it. So next time you're out in a boat and you get a message whose text is in pencil from days of yore, don't keep it all bottled up. It could end your day on an up note. We hope today's show did. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Back in college, I once talked my way out of a parking ticket. I was leaving for the summer and told the attendant that if she let me go, she wouldn't have to ticket me for at least 3 months. Well, that worked for me, but what's working for some students at the University of Alaska is paying their parking tickets with peanut butter and jelly. What? It's a program called Food for Fines. It's part of an annual food drive for hungry students. For people with unpaid fines, the more food they donate, the less they have to pay. For 1 week, the program includes PB&J. For the next, it's canned soup. Might make those who chose to pay in cash a little jelly. But it's easy to see, Sandal, which option to choose here. Sure, you can reach in your wallet for 50 smuckers, or you can skippy on over to the grocery store, buy some food in a jiffy, and things Peter pan out for the better just in time. For CNN 10, I'm hungry, and Carl Azuz. Okay, you heard phrases like eliminating car ownership and right around the corner, but you also heard words like prototype and test car. To be clear, experts say a cityscape with fully self-driving cars is likely to be decades away, and whether this would work in the country is another question entirely. For the present, even with all the technology available to us, drivers are still autonomous, mostly in control. And even if driverless cars seem the technological next step, the intelligence of smart cars is still artificial. So smart design will have to take the driver's seat if people are to take a backseat role on the road ahead. I'm Carl Azuz, and I break for CNN. If you had an unlimited supply of quarters, how long do you think you could play pinball? No one's ever done that as long as this guy. Ryan Clancy recently attempted a new pinball world record, and he didn't just do it for the glory. He did it to raise money for the Children's Hospital of Wisconsin. Ryan had to keep his fingers on the flippers, except to eat and drink. He was allowed a 5-minute break every hour, and after 32 hours and 2 minutes, the pinball wizard had taken the plunger and launched his name into the record books. In pinball, the playfield is never level. That's how the game is ramped up. And Clancy had to tilt things in his favor by springing into action and staying on the path while making sure nothing bumpered him off course. You know we're not arcading you when we say he really had to give a flip to defy gravity in scoring the new record. I'm Carl Azuz, always having a ball on CNN. Stella the talking dog gets 10 out of 10. Well, at least she's communicating. Her master is a speech pathologist who says the same methods she uses to teach children to communicate can be used to help dogs do the same thing. And while come outside may seem kind of basic, one time when a button wasn't working, Stella went over to the help button and pressed that. She's doing a pretty stellar job, if you know what I'm saying. And some dogs could hound you to death with that, making you terrier your hair out and hit the Malamute button. But it could also be a best ingenious invention, a Newfoundland way in the Corso Convislation, when your dog could multi-easily core give you the skipper keys to what he wants, at least most of the time. I'm Carl Azuz, and you knew this doggone show would come to an end schnauzer or later. Not sure I agree with my colleagues who say these things are adorable, but they are remarkable. You're looking at what are called mini cheetahs. They're frolicking around the campus of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Students are manipulating their every move with remote controllers, and while they're not as fast as real cheetahs, these only run about 9 miles per hour, they are hoped to help with deliveries one day or maybe emergency response. Want one? You may need to shell out around $10,000. But wait till you're spotted walking your cheetah. Some will say it's one cool cat, while others will call you a cheetah because your pet might have cat-like reflexes but run down with batteries, requiring a remote location and a recharge before it's ready to get back on its own 4 feet. Yeah, cheetah puns. You knew that. they'd have to be fast. And that's all we're feline-like saying on CNN. Last headline of the day, Florida man goes kayaking, captures monkeys raining from the sky. Okay, they were actually raining from the trees. There are hundreds of rhesus monkeys that live in Silver Spring State Park, and a whole barrel of them apparently decided to swim across the Silver River while the man who captured this video was paddling by. He says he believes the animals were being chased, possibly running from a fight with an alpha male. So better to run than to be left in rhesus pieces. I'm not going to have a better pun than that. We'll just leave it there. I'm Carl Azuz, and that's all the monkeying around we're going to do today on CNN. We started with weather, we're ending with weather. When we reported on the Sky Bridge that opened in Tennessee this May, we told you how it was the longest pedestrian suspension bridge on the continent. Another thing that makes it unique is the glass bottom that lets you see what's 140 feet under your feet. That same view in the snow may not be quite as clear, but look at the winter wonderland all around it. The folks who operate the Sky Bridge say it'll be open whenever it's not slippery to walk on. They're also calling it the Snow Bridge. If heights are the height of your fear and the cold freezes your fancy of fun, that might crystallize your determination to flake out on even an abridged visit and suspend any plans to step out when a bridge may ice in winter in favor of keeping your feet on frozen solid ground. I'm Carl Azuz. That spans another edition of CNN. For 10 out of 10 today, when things get stressful at work or school, how nice would it be just to reach down and pet your dog or cuddle your cat? That's the idea at some businesses in Japan where every day is take your pet to work day. Supporters say the office is happier, it may be more productive. In some cases, having animals around is said to attract more business. Of course, you risk getting some serious side eye. And on the downside, workers often have to walk out of the office. People with allergies find working much sneezier. Disagreements can become dogfights. Conflicts can become catfights. There's more threat of backbiting. And there are only human resources with no defined pet clause to settle rough reports and hissy fits that others find unamusing. Also, there's a whole lot more litter, y'all. Maybe this whole idea is best just left as a pet project. I'm Carl Azuz, hoping all of you have a wonderful weekend. Cleveland, Ohio is one of hundreds of U.S. locations that recently saw record cold for this time of year. But whoever this is knows how to make the best of it. It was from the 20th floor of a nearby hotel that a guest recorded a mysterious Spider-Man making his mark in an open field. Why is he mysterious? Because when the person who got the video went outside to see who it was, the man, like a spider, had hopped off his web and into thin air. Maybe he was feeling reclusive or he just liked using his long legs to go wandering somewhere else. But I don't need to say it took a tarantula lot of effort to weave such an orb-gorgeous display. Imagine what he could have done with eight legs. Now that would have jumped all over the World Wide Web. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. For 10 out of 10, 12 days, 14 hours, 59 minutes. That's how long it takes to fly a helicopter to all 48 contiguous U.S. states, assuming you're flying solo and setting the new Guinness World Record. Yosuke Chamalirat said he had two goals here besides the record. Inspire more people to learn to fly helicopters. He says more pilots are needed. And to show America's beauty from the air. He encourages everyone to dream big and keep pushing. Because even if you've hit the skids, that's not a bad thing in a helicopter. You just find your place in the rotation, stabilize your sights, ignore any rotor distractions. In no time, you'll be ready to lift off like a Blade Runner on an elevating transmission that defies gravity. For CNN 10, I'm Carl Azuz. At home. Iron Man breaks his own record. That's probably my favorite headline of the month. In this case, we mean a British inventor who built his own Iron Man suit. He set his first record 2 years ago, flying at 32 miles per hour. But then, earlier this month, with a new Iron Man suit, he destroyed that, setting a new Guinness record for fastest speed in a body-controlled jet engine-powered suit. He was flying, literally, at 85 miles per hour. Has he lost his mind? Can he see that everybody wants that suit?
Sadly, the Tony Stark truth when you get Downey to business is that you'd need more gold than iron to afford one. The end game is that it's just too expensive, though there's no doubt it's fun to marvel at. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. While Bebe's move to China got some people choked up, we'd like to share something that went down while he was in Washington, D.C. Did you know that pandas are built to withstand falls from trees? That's something I learned today on CNN 10 while watching this footage of Bebe take a dive. It's amazing the tree held up this long, but oh, there it goes. Not only was he unhurt, but he then showed us just how giant pandas scale trees. He was falling all over himself to do that. And I'm not going out on a limb when I tell you that Bebe is OKK and that he may know the way to try again when at first you don't stay treed. I'm Carl Azuz. Don't pan to puns, y'all. There's something we all must bear on CNN 10. Many Americans enjoy green bean casserole on Thanksgiving Day. This one is officially the biggest in history. It's a half-ton tray of milk, mushroom soup, green beans, and French fried onions. And it wasn't cooked up just to win the bragging rights of having a Guinness World Record. It'll help feed elderly New Yorkers who don't have family to celebrate with on Turkey Day. Total number of servings, 3,000. They're on a roll, a casserole that some would call delicious, and it makes their day their Turkey Day with Green Giant side dishes. Just add cranberry sauce, like a boss, and Jell-O if you're edgy and beyond the pale. You've tipped the scales with record-setting veggies. Yes, it took some beans to make it. We don't know how much it cost them. Still, for fans of green bean casserole and Fridays, it's awesome. I'm Carl Azuz. We will be on air next Monday and Tuesday before the Thanksgiving holiday. We hope you're able to join us then for more CNN 10. A demonstration of strength reveals a weakness. This is the prototype of a new Cybertruck, which the Tesla Auto Company hopes to start selling in 2021. The design is bold and controversial, but shortly after Tesla's CEO said its glass wouldn't break, even if you threw the kitchen sink at it, a metal ball went crack. To be fair, it did not go through the window, but when the designer tried again on the rear window, oops. As Time.com puts it, guess it's not all it's cracked up to be. Nothing's shatter foolproof, and even if it gives you a view into the when-dos and when-don'ts of testing, who's going to be making a pickup where metal balls are being thrown at your truck? You'd need to trade up for a tank and be thankful that even if something dreadful comes your way, you'll still have your steel to steal your vehicle, even if the view isn't what you glassed for. I'm Carl Azuz. Tomorrow's show is our last one of the week before the Thanksgiving holiday. We hope to see you turkeys then. Ten out of 10, more like 10,000 out of 10. Singer-songwriter Morgan Clark plays at a hotel in Nashville, Tennessee several times a week. After a recent performance, there was a little extra in her tip case, a check for $10,000. Is this legit? Yes, legit. Morgan says she's going to donate 10% of it to the Salvation Army, and she thanked the fan who wanted to remain anonymous for believing in her and giving her a shot. Well, thank you guys for believing in us, for Thanksgiving us the best audience, for digesting all the acorny puns I can bake up, for stuffing our inbox and social media with feedback, for being cranberry sauce-some, a cornucopia awesome, and for watching from feast to harvest. We're so grateful to gobble up 10 minutes of your day, and we hope your Thanksgiving is trip-to-fantastic. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. And finally this Monday, a feast with the beasts, or at least a meal for the monkeys. Why should people have all the fun of a Thanksgiving dinner? The Phoenix Zoo treated its squirrel monkeys to one of their own. No, it wasn't turkey and giblets. Do people still eat giblets? This spread included their usual salad, papaya, and bananas, cuz monkeys, and they seemed to enjoy eating it in Thanksgiving style. So in the kingdom of Animalia, we don't have to taxonomy ourselves to find core data on an orderly meal for which monkeys will be giving thanks. We just whip up a genus, or at least fruitful spread, that we can file them away for later to always know what the primate. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN. Truth be told, if you drive around in a giant banana car, you're going to get stopped. Steve Braithwaite got stopped by a state trooper.
The officer had a look to make sure the car is legal. It is, and probably asked some questions. This is the record holder for longest custom banana car. Braithwaite built it himself. He tours the country, giving people rides for whatever they want to pay. And instead of a ticket, the officer gave him $20. And after that, well, we wish we could say he peeled out. You wouldn't want to drive a banana car like a banana slug. It wouldn't be nearly as stimulating. Sure, the officer might have thought he slipped up, might have given him a bunch of tickets, but it would have made the story even more fruitful, y'all. I'm Carl Azuz, and CNN 10 will be bananack tomorrow. Godzilla has taken on his share of monsters since he made his film debut in 1954. King Kong, Destoroyah, Mothra. Here we see him taking on Mother Nature and getting completely snowed under. In central New York, a resident, the humankind, took this time-lapse video as a recent storm blew over. And Godzilla is ultimately coated by what the resident says was a mixture of sleet, snow, and freezing rain. Total accumulation was reportedly more than 10 inches. A monstrous amount that mashed the plant eater, burying the lizard in a blizzard, the fury in a flurry, the villain in the chill end, the miscreation and accumulation of precipitation that shocked a nation and gave a new meaning to the term monster storm. I'm Carl Azuz, and that eats up another edition of CNN. This is a perfect 10 out of 10 idea. Let's put this electric eel to work. The animal at the Tennessee Aquarium is named Miguel Watson. He's the electric eel. And somehow, engineers harnessed his shocks to power the lights of a nearby Christmas tree. When he's just swimming around looking for food, the lights blink a little. When he gets excited or he eats, the tree really lights up. We bet it glows like nobody's business when he hears his favorite Christmas song. Eel be home for Christmas, a holly jellied Christmas, we need a little fishmas, Eelies Navidad, it's beginning to look a lot like crustaceans, let it glow, let it glow, let it glow, I'm dreaming of a wet Christmas, silver eels, and of course every eel's undisputed favorite, shocking around the Christmas tree. Woo! I'm Carl Azuz, and eel be back tomorrow on CNN. Trampolines can be fun, especially if you consider yourself an extreme athlete who's ready to risk more than an injury to go airborne. A Slovenian group of stuntmen built the bouncy platform and then used a crane to suspend it 100 feet in the air. What happens if they go over the side? That's where the don't try this at home warning comes in. One of the acrobats says you can't help but feel dizzy when you're propelled in the air. But it gives them a unique platform, or springboard, from which to prove there's nothing they stratosphere as they tramp all over the lines others would draw when the air you catch is your only safety net and you vertigo for the height of fungi with a bungee that leaves everyone craning their neck in suspense. I'm Carl Azuz, and we gotta bounce, y'all. We'll catch you again tomorrow on CNN. For 10 out of 10, here's an event where getting the axe is how you get the party started. This is the World Axe Throwing Championships. It was held recently in Arizona, attracting axe throwers from, yes, around the world. And before you laugh, the prize was $15,000, and the event was broadcast on ESPN. This is not something you should practice in your living room, or probably anywhere outside a designated axe range. But if you're a lumberjack who knows jacks and hacks about the exacting and some would say relaxing sport of axing, you wouldn't be slaxing or finding anything taxing about attaxing a sort of board game that tests your mettle while you get a handle on busting the competition's chops. I'm Carl Azuz, reporting just the facts on CNN 10. If a deck is a bridge's surface, is it redundant to say deck the bridge? It's not if you're on this bridge in Tennessee. It's all decked out as part of Gatlinburg's efforts to show its Christmas spirit. This is the longest pedestrian suspension bridge on the continent, 680 feet of Great Smoky Mountain walkway that's also a tunnel of color. So if you're a fan of lights, you're not afraid of heights, and the cold never bothered you anyway, then leave the boughs of holly in the halls and join the chorus of jolly lads and lasses who are obviously heedless of the wind and weather as they take merrily measured steps across a bridge decked with fa-la-la lights that look like Yuletide treasure blazing across the valley as the old year passes. I'm Christmas Carol Azuz, and we'll see you tomorrow for our last show of 2019.
get a perfect 10 out of 10. This has been our biggest year ever, and today's last segment is dedicated to everyone who stopped by CNN Center. 'Twas 12 days before Christmas, and while I was working, I thought of the viewers who'd visited, lurking here in the food court at the CNN building, where sometimes I'd be taking pictures and fielding their questions and comments, suggestions that matter, hearing the cheering and shouts and the chatter. So grateful for all y'all who came for a visit. I'm asked the best part of my job. Well, this is it. To the thousands who stop by and millions who view, you're a gift that keeps giving to us. So to you, we wish you a wonderful holiday season, and thank you for being a wonderful reason to have this explainer show and its puns, that despite all the moans and the groans, they're still fun. Some say they're pun funny, some say they're pun laughable. I'm still pun stoppable, pun daunted, pun flappable. This show is my favorite one to be in because of you. You're the best part of CNN. I'm out of time for the rhymes, but our official YouTube channel is now live. This is the first time we're doing this. YouTube.com/CNN10, that's CNN10, is where you can subscribe to our show right now. Make sure to use that address for the official site, and we look forward to seeing you on this brand new way to watch the show. Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, season's greetings to everyone. I'm Carl Azuz for CNN.